Hey, what's good? What's good? What's good? Welcome to Reflections of a DJ, the Road Podcast. It's presented by DJ City. We got the special New York City edition here. I'm one of your hosts, DJ Crooked. We got DJ Never.
Yo, what up?
We got Jamie the Great.
Yep.
DJ D Miles is MIA, had to head back to Vegas. But we got a special co-host here, my man from Everyday People, one of my favorite dudes in the world, DJ Moma's in the building.
What's goody?
And we got two special guests here. And these dudes, I don't really know how to intro them, man. They're just complete legends to everyone in New York City. And I don't know, they're the greatest DJs that they're definitely in, I would say, in my top five DJs of all time. I gotta say that. And I don't know what else to say. I'm a little shook
it's
right
too
now.
Intense.
I can't
believe it's
happening. Sometimes. But we got
stop being shy, man.
I know. We got Eli Escobar in the building and we got Goldfinger in the building. Yo.
Yo.
I'm clapping for Goldfinger.
Yo, what's good, fellas?
What's good?
So we originally wanted to have an episode with Eli Escobar and we wanted to have an episode with Goldfinger. And Goldfinger is on some. He's just like, I wanna just lay in the cut. I wanna lay in the cut.
Yeah, I heard you guys are gonna be having Mo and yeah. I was like, I'll feel comfortable with these guys.
Okay, so they can sit in and just hang out and stuff and stuff. And you got some topics you passionately want to address.
No, I just listen to the podcast very, very carefully.
He's a listener.
He's got some issues he wants to address with Mo.
So you guys might see a fight in this episode.
Yeah, so he wants to address them with Mo, and then we'll see what's good. But Eli, people probably don't know this, but we grew up in the same building.
Yeah, we did grow up in the same building.
And then Never's from the Bronx.
And we went to the same elementary school. I didn't go from the kindergarten all the way up to eighth grade, but I did spend a few years.
You did PS 163?
I started PS 163, and then my mom pulled me out because it was horrible. And then I went to PS 75 for 4 years, and then my mom pulled me out of there because that was horrible.
Mm-hmm.
And then she put me in MCS for 3 years, and I hated it.
That's right. You were in MCS too.
Yeah, that's what I'm trying to tell you.
Shit.
Yeah, but you were what are you, 3 years younger than me or 4 years, something like that?
I think that. Yeah.
So
I went to PS 163.
Oh, you did for a little while
till first grade.
Did your mom pull you out because it was horrible?
It was rough, man. Yeah, it was rough. I mean, I was getting harassed. Like I was getting I was getting a lot of like fights and shit in there, and
right.
But I ended up getting. I took a test and I got a scholarship at MCS.
Oh, okay, cool.
And then I'm Asian.
Went to MCS.
Yeah, my math shit was like through the roof because I'm Asian.
Oh yeah.
So they were like, "Yo, we need this kid."
In first grade, your math was through the roof.
It was through the roof somehow. Wow, I don't know. They were just like, "Yo, we need this kid." So
right.
And I somehow got in there, but
cool. But yeah, we grew up in the same building. My mom.
You didn't like MCS?
It was just because If you go to the same school for like 4 years,
yeah,
and all your friends are there or whatever, and then my mom pulled me out, I was just mad that I was leaving my friends.
Yeah,
in high, like when I look back now, I realize it was a great school.
And so what we're talking about, MCS is Manhattan Country School. It's on 96th Street,
Fifth Avenue.
On Fifth Avenue,
yeah.
And the guy who founded it, the principal, Gus Trowbridge, right?
Mm-hmm.
He was very much in civil rights, and he like mm-hmm. worshipped mm-hmm. Martin Luther King Jr.
Yeah.
And he wanted to create a school that was like really diverse and culturally diverse and had all types of different classes in there.
Mm-hmm.
So he, and obviously it's in the Upper East Side. Mm-hmm. So he wanted, some well-to-do kids there, but he also wanted they try to do scholarships and for mm-hmm. So they try to mix it all up. So like my classrooms were like, I don't know, 20 kids in a class in per grade, actually.
Or less.
Yeah, actually 20 kids in a grade. And then, it was just like Puerto Rican, Dominican, Black, mm-hmm. Jewish, white,
yeah,
Asian.
Much, much to mixed. His credit, he really did succeed with his vision.
Great, yeah.
Yeah.
There's actually a lot of famous people that came out of that school. And I was privileged to go to that school. Yeah.
Yeah, it was a good place, but I was just mad that I was getting separated from my friends at PS 75.
Yeah, yeah.
And I never really got over it. So then after 3 years, my mom put me back in public school. Mm-hmm. I was such a stupid kid. Put me back in public school. Why are you trying to give me a better education?
But like from our building, right? From our neighborhood,
mm-hmm.
We were like right around the corner from the Goat Park, right?
Right.
Yeah.
Which was PS 163.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And then we had like, I didn't know them, but like those guys were kind of like the OGs in the building. Mm-hmm. But it was like Curious George, and Lord Sear. Lord Sear didn't live there, but he would come around all the time. Oh, yeah. And then,
but also to rewind a minute, a little bit, the park across the street from our building is where Crazy Legs and Frosty Freeze and the whole Rocksteady crew practiced. So you could see them practicing there in the early '80s, which was pretty amazing.
And they had the Rocksteady Park Jam there.
And the way I discovered that was I was just hanging out at my friend's house, and you know how some of the houses had balconies.
Yeah.
In the building, so in the summer of '93, we were hanging out on a balcony, and I could hear KRS-One across the street.
Yeah.
And I was like, "What the hell is going on?" So we ran downstairs and to the park, and he was performing. And then that was how I discovered that part. But that was the first summer anyway.
We used to call it the Rocksteady Park.
Yeah. Isn't that what it's called? Park.
Yeah. It has a couple of names. Yeah.
Yeah. It's like it's officially the Goat Park, though, right?
Yeah. Okay. That's named after a famous streetball player. Yeah. I can't remember his name. Goat. Earl the Goat.
Yeah. Earl the Goat. Yeah.
You know.
Yeah.
Okay.
And then we would see Curious George, right?
Yeah. I used to get terrorized by that whole crew.
Right.
Yeah.
It was
terrorized.
Why, they used to fuck with y'all?
I was like, so. By the time I hit like fifth, sixth grade, I started getting into like skateboarding and like listening to punk rock and stuff that wasn't like really that normal around our block. And yeah, I would get a little bit like made fun of when I would leave the house. They'd be like, "Radical dude," you know, stuff like that. And whatever. But then, you know, later on, it's like you all grow up and it's cool. Mm. And then once they saw that I was hanging out with Bobbito, I got a little bit more like respect, you know.
You got some juice.
Yeah. I just remember like my mom's knowing Curious George's mom, and then Cotty. Remember Cotty?
Yeah, of course.
Yeah, that dude like was the scariest motherfucker ever. But like, yeah, like I would be like mad young, and like Curious George's mom would be like, "Yeah, you should like come up to, like knock on our door and hang out with Curious George and hang out with those guys." I'm like, "Yo, those guys are like drug dealers or something."
They just
like,
used to sit with those kids. They would just sit in the lobby. That whole crew would just sit in the lobby, just like. To me, it seemed like they're just sitting there waiting to give all the kids that come downstairs mean looks.
Yeah.
Is that all they do all day? Like,
was this before he was rapping?
Not yet, because then I remember when I saw the video for Walk Like a Duck on TV, I was like, oh, man, that's the kid from our building. I didn't know he was rapping. I think he had sort of made a name for himself kind of like just on the street as a rapper, but I had no idea. I was too young, you know.
You saw him like on Video Music Box, right?
Yeah. Talking about like how he... supposed to get signed to Def Jam. Busta Sims offered him $1 million contract.
I think that's true.
And then he turned it down.
Oh, I don't know about that.
he signed with Columbia.
He said he turned it down. Yeah, eventually he signed with Columbia.
Probably when Bob was working at Def Jam, maybe he tried to bring him in.
Could be that, yeah.
It could be that. So, and then Bob left and started a label with Pete Nice. And they brought Curious in. And they were trying to get Nas too, I think. Mm-hmm. I'm not sure about that.
Okay.
Don't quote me on that.
But I mean, Columbia ended up signing Nas.
Big L.
Mm-hmm.
But it's also like they didn't know what to do with hip hop.
With that marketing department, yeah.
Right?
They had like Pete Nice, MC Search. Mm-hmm. But none of those albums like really popped off.
Nah, they didn't.
Because Curious George, like the first Walk Like a Duck, it did all right.
A little buzz. In New York, it definitely had some buzz.
But then Uptown Shit was like, that was a big record. For us, it was a big record.
Yeah. But you got to, like, this is a story I'll never forget. The first time I met Dante Ross, I was like, you know, kind of like, you know, I was working at a record store and he was there digging, and I was like, man, so what's it like to have been involved with that Brand Nubian album? Because that's like, if you were in New York in 1990, the Brand Nubian album was the
everywhere
record.
Yeah, exactly.
And I was like, did it go platinum? And he looked at me like I was out of my mind, and I think he said it sold maybe 150,000 copies.
It was bootleg.
That was platinum.
But also the regional aspect of it. It's like, you growing up in New York during that time, it felt like the whole world cared about these records. But
outside
you look
of New
back
York,
now, you're like, yeah, like hip hop wasn't even that big yet. You know, like it really wasn't. Well, it seemed like it was.
Brand Nubian did pretty well around the country. It was just like they did like the tours, the college tours.
Exactly.
And that's what was like popping at that time.
Right.
But they were like one of the few, because I worked in a record store at the same time. Mm-hmm. And
which record store were you at?
Beatstreet Records in Brooklyn.
Oh, right.
Well, I worked at all the record stores.
You guys didn't know that.
I didn't know that.
He was the face of Beatstreet.
He probably sold you 100 records.
Yeah.
To be honest, I never really went there.
It was far.
I rarely went to Beatstreet.
Yeah, I just went to Rock and Soul.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
Their that era was like the most bootlegged era.
It was.
And then this was at the same time when they were planning on, they were trying to stop printing vinyl for albums.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah.
So they were doing singles, but we're like Warner Brothers, Elektra, Atlanta. They all decided that they weren't going to, you know, book. Yeah. I mean, like they weren't going to like put out vinyl anymore. And, you know, there was no way you could really get those albums because all those albums came out as exports. I mean, imports rather.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. Or they would have the long box CD, which cost, which was really expensive.
Totally.
Right. So that was a little bit of a weird transitional. But anyway, my point was that I felt like it opened my eyes to how really regional these are. So you could be like, yo, but Walk Like a Duck was really popping off. But I think it's like you got to think about the rest of the country. You know what
I mean?
Yeah. Like,
exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah, for us it was like the anthem. Yeah. And I was like, we were just really proud, like, yo, that shit.
Yeah, I was I mean, I wasn't even cool with them, but I was like, yo, there's a rapper in my building. Yeah. Like, this is crazy.
But what do you call it? So you were actually working, you were at Beatstreet Goldfinger, and then you were actually at Bobbito's record store.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And it was footwork, right?
Yep.
And I know about the label Fondle Him,
right? Mm-hmm.
But I just didn't know he had a record store.
Yeah, it was like right around the corner from Fat Beats, the original Fat Beats.
No. So it was actually, so I think in 96, Fat Beats moved over to 6th Avenue. They got a bigger space. But Bob took the old Fat Beats.
That's right.
Oh, shit. So wait, that was never the original Fat Beats on 6th Avenue upstairs?
No, the original Fat Beats was really small. Well, really small. You never went to footwork either.
No.
It's like half the size of this room.
Oh,
that
really?
Was the, well, maybe like 2/3 of this room. That was the original Fat Beats.
Yeah.
And then so Bob took it over in 96 and kind of started like the first like
it was like version a sneaker, of
yeah,
it was sneaker like, shop and a record store.
It's like kind of like Fool's Gold is now.
Like, yeah, I don't know. I've never been there.
They sold like independent records.
Okay.
And basically it was a store that sold everything else but little like was, niche stuff.
Like, yeah, you know, exactly. Almost like you're like selling a lifestyle kind of like
pretty much.
But he was selling he had like really ridiculous sneaker connections. So he was selling secondhand or unworn out of print sneakers, which is kind of like the original Flight Club idea, right?
So. And then videotapes too cuz he used to
have like mixtape style and shit. Yeah, like yeah.
And like also, he used to sell like a lot of promo 12 inches as well. Right?
Yeah, I would get a lot of them too. That was the best.
That was hard to find that he used to have.
Yeah, because he was always like, he would be like, well, I already played it twice, so I don't need it anymore. Right, and I'd be like, what? What's wrong with you? Like, because I save everything. And so he would like, you know, get a promo that everyone wanted. Like, I remember he had the Off the Books white label.
Yeah, that record was from there. Yeah,
and it wasn't really. They didn't even make the Real Relativity promo yet. It was just the white label, and I was like, that shit. He was like, "It's cool. I don't know." You know, and like, and play. He was like, "I played it. You can have it now. I still got it."
So how did you link up to that record store? You just went in to get a job?
No. So it's not that long of a story. When I was in college.
Where did you go? You went upstate, right?
SUNY Purchase.
SUNY, okay.
Yeah.
I was thinking it was like RISD or one of those yeah.
When I went to SUNY Purchase, I was really involved, and it kind of surprises me now, but because I was kind of like way shyer back then and reserved, that I was throwing parties all the time, promoting parties and just making stuff happen up on campus. So I threw a party one time, and I booked Bob to host it, and I didn't really know him. And but he's from our building too. We didn't really actually mention that, did we?
He's from 120.
Oh, you didn't know that?
Really?
Yeah, yeah, wow. Yeah. 13th floor.
Are you serious?
Yeah.
Holy shit!
How you not know that, man?
Well, he's like 9 years older than me, so he's significantly older than Crooked.
Damn, I didn't know. I feel like like our building's like some legendary fucking.
Yeah,
man.
So you're always saying like, yo, Ellie grew up in my building. We grew up in the same building. Now he's gonna be Bobbito and
there was a basketball player, Mario Eli. Was he famous?
Yeah.
Yeah? He was from our building, too. Yeah. All right.
Damn, that fucking building was legendary.
I'm the last disappointment. That's
It went on there after you.
To me, I was like, they were like,
So anyway, I booked this party. Bob came up to host. He was just on the mic kind of emceeing the party. And we were hanging out, and I was like, you know, we grew up in the same building. And then we were sort of talking, and he was like, oh, I know your mom, you know? And so then, like, winter break or something like that, I went down to check out his store, and he was like, you want a job? So it was like that. Yeah.
Wow, man.
And
then how did you get into Beatstreet?
I got into Beatstreet just by, well, long stories. I used to just be like infatuated with buying records since I was like very, very young. Mm-hmm. My mom used to take me to buy records like from really, really young. So my zone school wasn't really a zone school for me. I was like kind of like an elevated type of, you know, learning type thing. So I went out of my neighborhood to go to, you know, elementary and junior high school. Mm-hmm. So when I would get off from school, the bus that I would take me back downtown Brooklyn. And it would be like 3-4 different record stores there. So I would just go to every single record store, find out what, you know. And I just would just be there all the time. It would be to the point where I would be there so much that I would like sweep up and shit. So
they would just give you a broom or some shit?
Nah, I just pick it up because I would be there. And then, you know, people like, you know, yo, you know this song? And they come in humming in and be like, yo, what's the song? And I'll be like, oh, that's that. You know what I mean? Yeah. And then after a while, I would just be like, you know, just ask him if he knows. You know what I mean? And I would know.
Yeah.
Then just came into a point where they were just like, yo, you want a job here? I was like, what? Like, I actually get
paid to do this shit?
Yeah. Because I'm spending like lunch money on records and shit. So, yeah. You know what I mean? So.
Yeah, I mean, that's one of the things I guess that probably doesn't exist anymore. But like people our age, like I feel like working at a record store was like almost just as important as getting gigs in the club.
I think it was more important.
Yeah, maybe more. It was like the dream. Like, oh, yeah. I work at a record store. You know, like.
Because it was, you know, now you can go on your phone, you can search a song and you can get the song. But back then, you were just like lost. It was like digging for gold.
Leave your house to go to the record store to get that record.
But it was even like, who do you talk to about which record store to go to? And who, where do, you know.
Well, you got to know people. That was the amazing thing about record store culture. Totally.
I remember the first time I stumbled onto Rock and Soul, I thought I found like, I was like, yo, this is like crazy. Like,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
It was just, and I was there like maybe 3-4 times a week, like copping records. And then you just kind of just searched around and then we would dig everywhere after that.
And then you get to know people.
Yeah.
I have so many friends that I still see on the street and it's like, I only know you because I always saw you at record stores. Yeah. You know?
But it's something very personal, very, I think it's almost, it's humbling to know that you can have a connection with people through music.
Definitely.
And then like, you know, you can actually build a relationship through just, oh, I remember I sold you that song or we had that connection off of that song. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, it's dope.
Were y'all like super friendly to like new people or you guys were like
only, he was friendly and I was terrible.
I think I was really friendly because I kind of like helping and I kind of like problem solving shit like that.
Yeah.
People coming in, oh, I need this record or, you know, this or putting somebody onto something that haven't heard.
You weren't the dude, like, let's say I just walked in and I was like 16 years old. And I was like, yo, I don't know the song, but I hear it everywhere and blah, 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 blah.
Nah, that was my shit. I do that shit now.
You do it? Because I would go to some record stores and they would like, yo, this dude's young. Like, they would like ignore me. They walk away or they would just be like, whatever. Mm-hmm. And that was probably Ellie, right?
No, well, if you asked Bob, he would say yes. The original staff at Fat Beats was actually the ultimate kind of snobby, unfriendly record store staff. And I remember going in there and feeling so crappy after leaving, like,
yeah.
And I don't even remember I never used to really ask anyone about records because I was just too shy anyway, but I remember just being like, why are they so rude,
right?
You know what I mean? And once I got a job there, I was like, I'm not gonna be like that. And then when I worked at Bob's store, I was just like really introverted. I don't think it was that I didn't want to help people, but that I sort of realized, like, when you work retail, you're always available to the public. Like,
you have to be.
You have to be.
That's the job.
Like, yeah. Like, you never know what's going to. And people used to really hang out hard at that store, like crews of kids. Like, and sometimes I would just be overwhelmed by it. Like, there's just too many people talking to me, like asking me questions. And then when I worked at Fat Beats for like a year after that, I really couldn't deal with it. I don't know why. I wish I could have been like you, because I remember going to Beach Street and you always had a smile on your face. And
yeah, like, it was like, know, this like, is the job, like that was like my favorite job ever.
Yeah.
And I did retail a lot of different places. Like, I worked at a Gap. I worked at like different places.
Yeah.
So it was like, you know, I knew what retail is, you know what I mean? But the record store is like something totally different.
Yeah.
So like, even if I'm not even working, you might find me at a record store.
Yeah.
You might find me at A1 and just be like, what the fuck are you doing here?
And now I hang out at A1 at least once a week for like hours.
Just got to.
Yeah, I just have to. Yeah, so it's I think I'd be a better record store employee now. than I was when I was 19 or 20, whatever.
Yeah. I remember hearing stories about Rock the Kind of Turntable Ladder.
Oh, yeah.
Just like that's belittling the customers stuff. And just like.
Yeah, I never belittled. I want to make that clear.
Yeah.
I never belittled anyone, and I was never like.
So you were like kind of from I was my boat, right?
Shy.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I was just like. Kind of like, man, this is not, people never stop coming in here.
So you
yeah. Which is good for the store. Like
so he wasn't like that intentionally. He was just like,
no,
he was shy.
I was like, I only came out of my shell, I think, in my 30s, like late 20s. Like, that's why I wanted to be a DJ in the first place. Like, I didn't want anyone to look at me. Like, obviously, it was weird because now everyone looks at the DJ, right? But mm-hmm. yeah, I wanted to be kind of in the back controlling the room, but yeah, I didn't want to have yeah. to like actually
have your face show.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, that's exactly. Kind of the difference that the how like DJing has evolved, right? Because the DJ actually wanted to be at the party.
Behind the scenes.
They wanted to be at the party, but they didn't want to be. They weren't kind of like they weren't like so outgoing to be like the life of the party,
right?
But they wanted to be a part of it. And then they were like, and then we were just fascinated on controlling the people.
Yeah, I mean, when I started going out clubbing in the early 90s, and like you would see like the dudes from Brooklyn with like the dreads and jabos like in the middle of the dance floor, like really dancing. I knew I wasn't going to be that
right.
guy, or, you know, and I wasn't a good dancer at all. And then I would usually like go to Soul Kitchen and just like stare at the records. So I kind of put it together pretty quickly. Like,
yeah, yeah.
I think I'm supposed to be back here. And
was yeah. that, how were you, Goldfinger, with that?
Well, my thing was, it was always music. Like, my mom's, she collected music. My pops collected music. So, music was always my thing.
Mm-hmm.
Like, I never really wanted to do anything else. Yeah. And it's like, I just found it really, really early. And when I tell people, I was like, yo, I started DJing when I was like 7 years old. People look like, yo, you're 7 years old? You're cool and crazy. But like, if you think of like the DJ Just, like, you know that kid DJ Just, like from back in the days?
Oh.
He's like the little small kid on
I know who you're talking about.
Oh, right. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, they had a little. And he was DJing when I was like 9 years old. He's cutting up and, you know, doing all this stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's like, it didn't seem weird to me at that point.
Yeah.
That it would be somebody that age that was doing it.
No.
Because that's just weird. How I grew up.
Yeah. And did you have two turntables by the time you
No,
age?
No.
Yeah,
no.
Yeah, yeah.
I got my first record player at 7 years old. I didn't want a bike. I didn't want nothing. I used to like collect baseball cards and records. And one day it was like my baseball cards were all over the floor or whatever I was doing. And my mom's like, choose. Either it's going to be these records, these baseball cards. And I had dope baseball cards too. And I threw them away because I was just like, fuck it. You know what I mean? I'm just going to do the records. And I just did the records. And then from there, that was just it.
Who were some of your influences going? Wait, what part of New York are you from?
Did I'm from downtown Brooklyn, and I'm from a place called Wyckoff Gardens. And Wyckoff is special because it's the birthplace of Houdini. Houdini lived on the 17th floor. I lived on the 14th floor.
All right, we got nothing on this guy.
Yeah.
That's it. I mean, especially.
Just burned the whole building up.
I mean, so I remember 20. When there was only two albums out, Run DMC's and Houdini.
Yeah, so it was real big. Like, we, like the people in the projects, we saw them leave for Fresh Fest.
Yeah. Wow. I'm glad we talked about our building first before your building.
Nah, it was pretty
good. Shout out to Curious George.
Yeah, shout out to Curious. It was pretty big. That was a big thing. Like, we used to have like Red Alert come do like Kiss parties, like near our hood and stuff like that. Wow. It was a big thing. You had like big DJs. You had Big Bob from like Empire Skating Rink, so he was really big. Then you had like Flowers, but he was at the end of his career, but he was like, he used to do power.
He was like the boy in the beginning.
And, yeah, it was like, you know, he used to do like big block parties and stuff of that nature, like in the big parks. Then like Mills, Baby Mills, and the disc, you know, there was a lot of talent in you know, the area. And then not too far from there was like, you know, Fort Greene, so, you know, with all that stuff with, you know, then later on with Kane and that area. And so it was like our little section was pretty rocking. So
when you were when you were getting into DJing at seven, what was your focus?
My focus was just to be able to do it because I didn't have equipment.
Was it mixing or was it?
No, my thing was when just having the records. The records was the most important thing. It would be like you would have to listen to the radio for like 2-3 hours to finally hear something new.
Right.
Because if you listen to radio, hip hop radio, Friday and Saturday, you listen to the whole show from 7 to 12. you know, right. you listen, you yeah. listen the whole way.
We would, I mean, we would record it on cassette.
But most of those songs, if you heard them, you heard them again. You heard they played them again or whatever. They repeated them or whatever. And then if you taped them, you pretty much had them on tape. So that means you had them. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Until they came out on record, until you can have them physically, you had it on tape. So you would just wait for that new record that nobody had heard or he hadn't played before. And then usually Red Alert would come with some joint and you get it on tape and you hopefully you get it from the beginning because, you know.
Yeah.
It was really like.
Remember that feeling when you didn't catch it from the beginning?
Yeah, yeah. But
it's then, like, I don't really have it.
But then it's like if your friend was up and then he had it, then you would trade a song. You'd be like, yo, you heard this song. And then let me get that from the beginning. You trade. This shit was amazing. It was like the best time in the world.
I'm trying to think about what was the span of time from when a DJ was, let's say a DJ broke a record, Red Alert broke a record on the radio, right? What was the time when you were able to actually buy that record?
It was pretty quick, actually. It was pretty quick, but not quick in these terms. Like now it's like you can go and get something off of the fucking internet the next day.
Yeah.
But like the one example I can say is the South Bronx, right? The South Bronx happened, and that was on the acetate, and they brought that to Red Alert, and Red Alert played that at Latin Quarter, right? Mm-hmm. So they played that record. My friend went to the Latin Quarter that night. He got punched in his eye, right? Because the Latin Quarter was real, real rough. Yeah, so he was young, so he must have been about, I must have been about 14, 15. He must have been about 16, 17. Went to Latin Quarter.
This is Latin Quarter on 97?
No, Latin Quarter in 44th. Like, 44. Like right 44. In the middle of, right so in the middle
I didn't
of
know this Latin Quarter. Like, I knew the 97th Street Latin Quarter.
Yeah, that was like later on in the years. Yeah. This is the original joint.
This LQ. This is the LQ. Yeah.
Okay, okay.
All right, so he goes to Latin Quarter and he gets punched in the eye, whatever, this, that, and the third. And I see him in the elevator and he's got like a visor over his shit. Like, and this shit is rocked, like speed knot. Big, like his whole face is like half his face is swollen. I'm like, yo, what the fuck? He's like, yo, man, went to the club last night. I'm like, what? He was like, yeah, man, I'm going back. I'm looking at this nigga like he's crazy. Like, yo, you can't be serious. He was like, yo, the bridge is over. I mean, no, he was saying South Bronx. But then it was a span of maybe that week or maybe in 2 weeks, the bridge is over came out. It was that quick. It was that quick where the response happened. That quick. But the records hadn't come out.
Right.
Because the record was Word From My Sponsor and South Bronx. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And then right after that, it was Bridges Over was out. I was like, how the fuck? And it was just like magic. It was like you heard it on the radio and then it became a sensation. Like Roxanne came out.
I remember when that
and then Roxanne Was a Man came right out. Roxanne Was Gay. Roxanne Is This. Roxanne's a Man.
Roxanne's Doctor.
Roxanne's Doctor. Roxanne's Got Herpes. You know what I mean? It's like it was so many Roxannes, but they came right really after fast. Because it was no labels. It was just like, let me get this shit pressed up and let me put it out.
But it wasn't
available.
And they were
selling for so many records, too.
No, actually, it was available, but after it first came out, once it sold out, you couldn't find it for a while. It was that type of, the turnaround was bad.
Yeah.
You get what I'm saying?
Just like restocking and shit.
There you go.
Was it vinyl or was it all acetate?
Vinyl. Did you ever, I don't know if The Wiz was still around.
Yeah, The Wiz was on 97.
Yeah, so I used to go to The Wiz when I was in those years. Like, I bought Roxanne's Revenge at The Wiz. They had a hole downstairs with just 12 inches on the wall.
Dude, we had the best block, though. The fact that we could walk two blocks down to there Broadway, 97th Street, definitely. And go to The Wiz.
Yeah, and there was also some other record stores, Spanish record stores, on one on 96 and one on, like, 100 past that pizza place on 100 and, or 98th or whatever. But they would also sell, like, all the record stores had a section that were, like, 12 inches. Where you could get all the, you know, club stuff and hip hop.
I got you beat. My area, Albee Square Mall.
So
you got to think. The Albee Square Mall.
Did they have a record store in Albee Square Mall?
They had record stores, but it wasn't really like weird destination. Like everything outside of the mall area were destination. Right. You had like Music Factory. You had The Wiz at one time. You had Crazy Eddie's. You had Powerhouse. You had Music Factory. You had Beatstreet.
Right.
Jackpot. was crazy.
So
it was
like, and Beat Street was already around in the mid 80s?
Late 80s, yeah. Like 88. Right. And right. I worked at like Powerhouse before then. Oh, and then just moved down the block. And right. then when Beat Street came, it was like they had already knew me because I already yeah. worked down there. Oh, actually, Clark Kent used to work at Music Factory down right. down there as well. Yeah. DJ Clark Kent.
Yeah. Fucking. I'm trying to remember like how when we heard a record on the radio, like if I heard Gangstar Mass Appeal, like when did that shit, like how long did it take to come out?
It really was, it depended because yeah. like especially once college radio really took over, you had people like getting stuff on DAT. So you know, like Stretch and Bobbito is the best example. They were friends with everybody, so Premier might give them a DAT of a new song,
yeah,
and Stretch would start playing it like it could be like 3 months early or 4 months early.
So like in the 2000s, right? When like, let's say, I don't know, like Put Your Hands Where I Can See, Busta Rhymes came out, right?
That's not
98. Yeah, sorry. I'm really horrible with you. Sorry, guys.
Damn, they all came out of the woodwork.
I got triple teamed right now.
It was four, right?
I actually, you know what? I actually have a funny story about that song. Not a funny story, but it's all related to this. I DJ'd at El Flamingo?
Yes.
Yeah, that was 20, a spot. Totally. El Flamingo, when that record had just hit the radio, and I was still, it was what, 98?
Or 97.
Yeah. 97. So I was just getting in with like the knowing promo people and stuff. I wasn't like all the way there to the point where I was getting everything. And I didn't have that record.
Mm-hmm.
And the first thing the promoter asked me when I got to the club was, you got Put Your, whatever it's called. Yeah. And I was like, no, I didn't get it yet. Yo, he got mad at me.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, we need to figure this out. And like literally like was freaking
gonna,
out.
Yeah, that was going to be. I guess
he had something, or it was maybe a cell phone. Like it was 97. He had a cell phone. He started making calls. And like 2 hours later, I met the Elektra promo person for the first time. And they came and brought it.
Yeah.
But like that's how it's like.
Yeah. Actually, that took a while for it to come out on 12-inch. Only the promos. They only released the promos at the time.
Yeah, it was only promos.
Yeah, for that's why I didn't have it.
I got it at Kim's Video. They used to have promos also.
They did, yeah.
I'm thinking back then, like, I didn't know where to get that shit, and I would go to Rock and Soul, but I was trying to think, when that came out and it played on the radio, would they take it from the radio, or someone at the radio station would just repress it onto, like, the killer cuts, like, those bootleg labels?
A lot of those bootleg joints happen, and I have to give up the ghost. A lot of those joints happen because the guys that used to do the classic remakes, or the, you know, like the Before I Let Go, mm-hmm. TK Discos, mm-hmm. I mean, like those type of, they actually did those.
Mm-hmm.
They actually put those records out. And they only really did it because I kind of like suggested them to do certain records.
Mm-hmm.
And then it just got
out of control.
Right. Like,
so you spoke with them and you told them?
Yeah, totally. Because I used to be a buyer at the store. So,
and so you're like, everyone's looking for these.
Everybody's looking for these records, or this record needs to be put out. And then it was kind of like.
Did you handpick the songs? And which
most
ones?
Of them.
Really?
Most of them.
Wow.
So a lot of the things was the labels, like I was saying before, the labels were really trying to cut out vinyl.
Mm.
Like Weir, the Warner Brothers, Elektra, Atlantic, they were really trying to dead vinyl.
For what though?
Because it was just cost cutting.
Right.
So if the biggest conglomerate of, you know, people that was doing hip hop at that point deaded hip hop or deaded vinyl, that's when like KRS was like on his album, oh, we need vinyl, you're killing us. That was the same era. It's 92, 93. So that's why like Das Effects wasn't on vinyl.
I was pissed off about that.
Diamond was never on vinyl. Was only import.
Mm-hmm.
Brand Nubian, all that stuff was all in the same label, same, you know, type of situation. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So a lot of those records, if you think about it, like Sally, the Out of One Track Mind, was on a bootleg,
mm-hmm.
but it wasn't on a single until after it got big. And then it was certain little picks, like Step to the Rear. It was so low on the album. You had to have it on a bootleg just so you can hear it well in the clubs. So a lot of these are like the little suggestions that I made, or, you know, or like Brand Nubian. You had to have a little bit more of an oomph to it because the album was pressed so bad.
Yep.
Because they didn't want to press them.
What's the song that had no bass in it?
Cypress Hill. Cypress Hill album was horrible.
Yeah, horrible.
And then on top of that, Cypress Hill's album was...
had a glitch in it. So it was a scratch already in the vinyl.
On everybody's copy.
On everybody's copy. After they made the certain batch, it was a scratch already in it.
Yeah.
So it was already a rare album. And then on top of it, it was a scratch in it. So now we got to do singles or we got to do bootlegs. You know what I mean? Wow. So Hand in the Pump. All that stuff was on bootleg first before they started putting on this. You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
Had to.
I just remember, like, before you got the plug for the promo records and all the promo guys.
Yeah, you had to buy those.
You had to buy. At one point, my whole record crate was just all bootlegs.
Yeah, but they were pushing everybody to buy CDs, and they were really cutting out the singles. Actually, they didn't get it. And I'm coming from a retail background. It was we used to have meetings and go to like these conferences and talk about the mom and pops. Yo, we need this because this is how we train our customers. Right, right. And they didn't get that point of it. They just thought we make so much money off of the CD. It costs us 70 cent for the CD and we making this shit $15.99, $19.99 for the CDs. We're making so much money. They didn't care. Buy the CD.
How much was the album costing to make? Or the vinyl cost to make?
Oh, it's costing a lot more. Way more. It's costing like $4 or $5. Yeah. And then they would sell it for like $7, $8 maybe. Yeah. And if it was a double, what you needed at that point, because people were making more songs. The more songs you have, you know, the less validity you have on the vinyl. So you had to make double vinyl. You know what I mean? And
it
just weighed too much. So that's where the bootlegs came in at.
I was always wondered like how they put those together, because those saved my life. The Prince. Having like, you know, with like multiple albums, like all the hits from multiple albums on like on A side A and side B.
Yeah, but by that time, if that wasn't really the purpose of them, the purpose was them for you to have the record and for you to have it to where you can play it in the club and keep it going. Mm-hmm. Or if it was a single that you weren't going to buy that album, like fucking Arrested Development. You know, that remix was a big, but it was like, yo. They don't have that version on the fucking album. You got to put it out.
Right.
And then until the bootleg came out, they didn't realize that that was the joint you had to have. So then they put the single out.
Does that still happen? I'm going to confess that I'm not really... I listen to hip hop still, but I'm not like in it, like obsessed with it the way I was as a kid. Does it still happen where the version that everyone wants to hear in the club or they play on the radio or there's in the video is not the version on the album?
Totally.
Oh, yeah. That was one of the great tragedies of the 90s. Like... You buy the Black Sheep album and you'd be like,
this is not the right version.
What is this?
Choice is yours.
Wait, what do you mean? Music, like the hip hop.
Remember when AZ's album came out? The Your World Don't Stop was mad weird. Yeah. I was like, that was his best song. What did he do? Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Were you saying that the hip hop right now, if it's the.
I was just asking if that's still a thing where like the one that everyone wants to hear is not the one that's on the album.
Oh.
But you can just buy anything on iTunes, right? I mean.
Right nowadays, it's usually the album cut, right?
It's a certain, you know, versions that is different.
But it's a different dynamic, right? Because like a meme could take a song from just being an album cut to being number one, right? Like with Drake's In My Feelings. So nobody really needs a different version. People just cop whatever's on the album.
Right. Yeah, no one's making really albums like that anymore. I mean, like the singles are coming out and then they start remixing it or changing it out. And then usually the first version right now is horrible, sounds horrible. Because it's not mixed down, or
they leak it. Like
they leak it, or it was produced from some kid in his bedroom, who didn't know how to master it, and he just gave it, sold it to the rapper. The rapper recorded it, and he just pushed the sent the digital.
That's for new artists,
yeah,
like the new SoundCloud artists. Yeah. You know what I mean,
no, but that's even Drake. In My Feelings, that happened, where like this it was the song, it was not mixed properly, it was not mastered.
It still sounds horrible in the club.
Yeah, there's multiple records like that. I think that. Even Tatiana at some point was. I have like three different versions that are mixed down differently. With like, the Cardi B remix sounds totally different from the original.
Yeah,
the instrumental sounds different.
Yeah, it's just all mixed horribly. It's just like digital copies just getting emailed and sent, and then someone's mastering it differently.
Right.
Yeah,
they're just pushing it out.
Yeah,
they're just pushing thinking it about out. the sound quality.
Right.
Well, I can't really shit on all the new stuff because back in the days of the 90s, it was some really horrible sound. Yeah,
especially the mid 80s. I mean, you had Marley just making records in his house.
But those sound good, but it's
kind of like charming though. Yeah. It's like you listen to like Just Rhyming with Biz and Big Daddy Kane's mic is distorting.
Totally.
But it's the best.
But it had character to it. You know what I mean?
And that's how I feel about a lot of the new stuff. I actually really like a lot of the new stuff I hear, even though I'm not like completely knowledgeable about it, because I can feel like, oh, some kid just made this in his room. I love stuff like that, you know?
Yeah, but I'm just thinking about like more like the 90s. Like
93.
Like 93 was a horrible year, man.
And to the stage.
And to the stage, Wu-Tang. Wu-Tang was a horrible sounding
yeah,
album.
Yeah.
You had like, even a Snoop Dogg. Snoop Dogg was clear, but it was too crispy. When you played it in the club, the shit was like, that's why the singles rang off so much on Snoop Dogg shit. Yeah. You know what I mean?
Midnight Marauders was until they did the double press.
Yeah. But the singles were so dope.
Yeah, they knew how to mix records. If anybody knew how to mix records,
it was Bob Powers, right?
Yeah.
Fucking engineer.
But they had so many records on the album that it kind of lowered
the whole album. Yeah, it didn't sound good, like the album cuts.
Yeah.
You couldn't play in the clubs.
You couldn't play them.
So like moving forward from Fat Beats, from Beat Street, Ellie, you actually did Farnham Records.
No, I mean, I didn't.
I mean, you worked at...
Yeah, I worked at the store. What happened? Oh, you mean like I put out a record on Fonda?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I didn't even know this record.
I really would like to not talk about that.
I came across it last night.
You know,
I was going to play the record.
I think some people...
I came across it by accident. I was like, oh, shit, I ain't that early.
What I think about... Look, there's some people like someone like Q-Tip who made the best records of his life when he was like 20 years old, right? And then there's people like me who somehow start making good records in their mid-30s. I don't know. It just took me a really long time to figure it out.
I liked it.
Nacho.
Come on, I'm serious, man.
Moment, did you hear this? Have you ever heard this before?
I really don't want to do this. Play. I really don't want to do this.
He's about to walk out.
This is the edit point.
I don't think you're in the same building.
Oh man! So actually, it sounded like a typical late '90s underground hip hop record.
Yeah,
yeah.
It sounded like a Beat Miners beat to me, like heavy bass, heavy filtered.
Yeah, I mean, it was the S950 and the SP1200. Everyone was using it.
And, I'll play for you guys after. But what do you call it? And then you had like a radio show, Night Train, right?
So yeah, I started really like you know, hanging out with Bob pretty heavy, and to the point where I would probably at this point be comfortable saying it was sort of like he was a mentor, like introducing me to all the promoters.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he was DJing. I don't even think he was comfortable with his DJing yet, but it was one of those things where like he was famous, so people would just give him gigs, and then he would have me open for him. At lots of places, and got me my first two residencies ever.
But you would also do guest sets on Stretch and Bobbito,
so,
right?
Yeah, so the first time I ever DJed on the radio, I was hanging out with Bob in Brooklyn, and we were taking the train back to Manhattan, and he had just found out Stretch was in Japan. He used to find out, like, they weren't on the best terms in those days. And he would find out, he'd be like, Stretch is in Japan, and it's Sunday, like, they had Hot 97 on Sundays at this point. He was like, it's Sunday. The show starts in 2 hours. And he just let me know he's in Japan. Like, he would be really frustrated with him. So we were on the train, and I guess he had just found out. I don't know how. He didn't have a cell phone, but somehow he had found out the Stretch wasn't around. And he was like, you want to spin on the radio tonight? So I was probably 20 or something. And the first time I ever played on the radio was on Hot 97.
So crazy.
That night, Craig Mack came up. Yeah, it was 97. Craig Mack was promoting an album that never took off. I don't even remember what it was called, but he was mad cool. I remember Craig Mack was mad cool.
You got what I need? Some shit like that.
Do you remember the song he put out in 97? Yeah. I don't remember it.
Yeah.
I don't remember that shit.
What's that?
Ooh, there goes another rubber tree.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah. That rings a bell.
Oh, wait.
Yeah.
Is that it?
Yeah.
But it didn't pop off,
yeah,
though.
Nah.
But yeah, so it was a Sunday night in the summer of 97. I went on the Hot 97 and played, and the crossfader was leaking. I remember that really well. I think Flex had done a number on that crossfader. and Craig Mack came up, and I was like, this is crazy. My best friend who grew up in the building was downstairs on Hudson Street with a box taping it, because I was just like, so like, we couldn't believe it, you know. He was like, yo, I'm coming, I'm gonna tape it, and then we'll listen to it on the walk. We'll just walk. Mm-hmm. Like, we probably didn't get on the train till like 42nd Street. We just walked.
Wow.
And then shortly after that, I started regularly filling in on 89.9 and Hot 97. So I caught the bug. I was like, I was just loved it being on the radio. And then like had my own show too on 89.9 where I was playing like original stuff that people were sampling. Mm-hmm. That was kind of like I was real into that. I was buying records. Like I still didn't even have a pair of Technique 1200s at that point because I couldn't stop spending money on records. Mm. I had the $99 Gemini belt drive. Mm-hmm. Belt drive? Were they belt? The ones?
Yeah. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You had to like if you wanted to bring in a record, you had to be like, and hope it would land. But I got really good at those things, you know. And
slip mats.
Yeah, I remember people would be like, "Yo, Ellie, just save your money and get Techniques." I'd be like, "But I want to buy records." And they have Techniques at the clubs, so it's cool, you know? And so I was just spending ridiculous amounts of money on records. So I had, like, all these old, 70s records. And I was really into disco and funk and all that stuff, R&B. So I had a show on 89.9 where I played that kind of stuff.
And that was Night Train, right?
Yeah, that was Night Train. And where then did they kicked us from? Off.
Where did that name
from? No, that's the way it works at Columbia is, like, all the time slots already are named.
Oh.
So it was just like, this is the Night Train time slot, and you get it. Something like that. I don't know.
And you said you were playing samples?
Yeah, but then also hip-hop, but then that's why they kicked us off. Because I was like, it was 4 hours, and I wanted to play hip-hop too and bring people up. We had, like, you know, lots of guests up. And then they found out we were doing that. We violated the programming. Hmm. It was like programming from 1 to 5 a.m. on Tuesdays needs to be jazz, funk, R&B, blah blah blah. Mm-hmm. And we were just stupid. We was like me and a couple of my friends, and we violated that that programming guideline, so they kicked us off. Wow. Yeah.
How long did you guys last though?
Like a year and a half, something like that. Yeah. And also it was like some dumb stuff, like some of the people that we brought up with like stealing records and doing graffiti. It was a lot of that kind of stuff. So
what clubs were you doing at that time?
So let's see, like 97 was like, well, I used to do Pravda, which was like
on Lafayette.
Yeah, Lafayette downstairs. It was like, you know,
that's what it was.
It was like a place. It was like the crowd was terrible. It was like it wasn't like dancing. It was like people being seen and
just hanging out, chilling.
Yeah. And I would play like I remember they yelled at me once, like, "You gotta stop playing so much Sade," because I would just be playing mad Sade. I'd be like, it just kind of fits the vibe, but I don't know. It wasn't really like a party. And then I started doing this party. At 205 Club. 205 Club has been around for a really long time in various incarnations. Mm-hmm. In 97, they used to have a Friday night party that was really, really good. It was just like your average late 90s hip-hop, reggae, R&B, classics night. Mm-hmm. And then Saturdays, I started doing this other party that moved around and eventually ended up at this place, 95 Leonard, which is where I met Goldfinger. Mm-hmm. Cause he got brought in by another promoter, Adam, and that was a big. I wanted to talk about that since you're here, cause that was a really cool. The first time I ever heard him at that party was a really cool moment. I had fallen into this kind of like idea of like, all right, the way you DJ is, you play classics from 10 to 11, mm-hmm. then from 11 to like, you know, 12:15, you play old school hip hop that everybody loves.
Yeah.
Then at like 12:15, you might do like a real quick reggae set. Then at 1, you play all the new stuff. Bangers. Boom, 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 boom. Then you play
wait,
more.
Wait, I still DJ like that.
Hold on. And then at 2:30, you start bringing it back to some old school
shit.
And then by 3, I used to wait till 3 because I wanted to play Alicia Myers and
the Gap R&B, Band. And,
yeah,
R&B
I was just like, I can't wait till 3. I can't wait till 3. 3 o'clock, go into all that stuff. Mm-hmm. First time Goldfinger came into the party, he tore that whole thing down. Like, I'm playing New Edition at 1 in the morning, and everybody loved it. And I was like, damn, he's better than me. And he plays whatever he wants at whatever time of night. He's not restricted by this kind of, like, idea of how a night should go.
That's one thing about Goldie is his instincts. Mm-hmm, because you could never guess what was being played at what hour.
Right.
And sometimes it would be almost like counterintuitive, like, are we listening to the Locks right now?
Right.
It's like, it's 12:30. I was just jamming to Shaka Khan, but the entire room just erupts.
And that's all that matters. You know, right? Yeah.
I mean, how do you break down the night? How do you approach it? The Goldfinger.
Just feel it out, right?
Every night is different. Yeah, it's just like, it depends on the vibe. It depends on, you know, the atmosphere, the club. It's a lot of different factors. Men to women ratio.
Has it always been like that for you?
Always. Really? See, I grew up DJing like block parties, so you had to kind of like be cognizant of everybody that was in the area you had to play.
What was the first thing you try to notice to read the crowd?
The first thing is you have to know who's there. You have to know who's there. You have to know if those people are partiers. You have to know if those, and you can kind of like get it from certain songs. You put on a song, you'll see who's bopping, who's moving, and you kind of focus in on that. See what type of emotion are you getting from what they're giving you off of that record.
I always call them like the test the test songs.
Oh yeah, totally.
That kind of like they're kind of more the widespread. Litmus, yeah. They kind of, they're a little more widespread and they're a little bit more even, but like these five or this group of people who aren't dancing, if they start dancing, you're like, "Oh, this opens up another door to go that way even deeper." Does that?
Yeah,
and
definitely.
Then kind of, you know what I mean?
Yeah, my thing is like I have records that I call the gimmies. So it's like I'll play a record, I'll get a sign. Okay, let's see. And then I'll try to stretch it out a little bit more.
Yeah.
Give me a sign. See if I get any resistance or whatever. Mm-hmm. Stretch it out a little bit more. See how far I can take it before you start to get that, you know, I'm not interested, or you know, my attention span is not exactly on the music. Mm-hmm. Then I'll bring in a gimme record where it brings everybody back into the fold, and then it's like I have to train you again. Like,
right.
And then I just
full disclosure, I learned that from watching Goldie.
Yeah,
like literally, like I think you're one of the first DJs that I seen really scan the crowd. Like I used to say Goldie DJ's like a lifeguard.
Yeah. And I remember you would come real early.
Yeah.
And he would like, I would see him come in with a couple of bags, leave, come back with more bags, leave, come back with more bags. I'd be like, how many records is he bringing? They would be like this crazy amount of times back and forth. But then he would hang out and just be like, just keep playing and really like survey the thing. And then you would always be like, all right, I remember you didn't like playing dance hall.
I like playing dance hall, but in the city it's a lot different because I'm from Brooklyn, they really go crazy for dance hall.
Yeah,
but in the city at that point it would be like, and a lot of the parties I was doing, they were more like not really industry, but the kind of industry. Mm-hmm. So if you have people like an industry, then they're working together, and they're not necessarily going to be rubbing up on each other.
Right.
So it's kind of what? I'll play that a little bit later, but I'll play it before people start thinking about looking at their clock and like, yo, it's almost time for me to go home.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
That type of thing.
Right.
So when you guys, like during this time, Neva, you were spending too, right?
Yeah.
Late 90s?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And we were kind of going through the names of clubs throughout the 90s. So I don't know about the early 90s too well. So you guys can school me, but I'll start at the late 90s since we're already in that pocket. Coney Island High?
Yeah.
Blow Pop, remember that party?
Blow Pop.
Yeah.
DJ Hero.
I played at Coney Island High.
And this was like the beginning. And this, so that club, was it Pravda?
Yeah, it wasn't a club though. It was like,
it was a lounge.
It was a lounge, but it was like a restaurant at the top.
Yeah, they had a restaurant. They used to give me a meal every night.
So I think that's literally the first night I've ever actually been to like a club or a bar that played hip hop all night and reggae and R&B.
At Pravda?
Oh, and it was, and you were spinning there.
Oh, really?
And
no, I know what you're talking about.
That's not so, Pravda?
Yeah, you're talking about, this is the party I was talking about that he eventually joined me at, but at the time
it was downstairs.
Downstairs on Houston between, yes. It was called,
and where that was it?
It was on Houston between Thompson and LaGuardia, and I don't remember what it was called though.
It wasn't that bar, man.
Oh, E&O. It was called E&O at first. And then they changed the name when we were down there. And I used to DJ sitting down for some weird reason. It was like they didn't have a DJ set up.
Yeah.
It was like every Friday and Saturday night they would bring out turntables and a mixer, but it was on a real low table. Mm-hmm. So I would have to sit down for it to feel comfortable. But that was one of the best parties. And it was like I could see you being there because it was like a real New York City kids party.
Yeah.
Like a lot of the kids that were just out of school. We'll all go there.
It was like the first, but like I would try to get into all these bars and clubs. I would never be able to get in. Mm-hmm. Like, but that was the first time I actually got in. And I saw you and I'm like, yo, that dude lives in my building. And I was with my homie Philippe and all like, you know, we're just like, you know, we weren't even 21 yet probably. Right, and then we were like, and it was the first time I danced with a girl in an actual club.
And were you already DJing? Like,
no, I wasn't DJing. Oh, I was like, okay. I was actually into beats and I was like, quote unquote, rapping at the time. But like, that's another story, but I was And then I remember I was just, it was like the best time of my life because I was hearing all the hip hop, all the R&B and all the reggae that I wanted to hear. And then I was dancing with a chick for the first time. And I got, I remember we were dancing and I've never danced that long. We were probably dancing like 2 hours straight with the same girl. She had a red dress on. and then when I left the club, the red dress had rubbed off on my jeans and my jeans was red.
Oh, oh my god.
Yeah, you better hope that was only the dress. Yeah,
it was a dress. It was just
Do you dress. Remember any other song you remember any songs you heard that night?
I remember hearing like the dope reggae set and I heard like everything like probably like Heads High, and it was at the time where I don't know, like I didn't hear that remix before.
Give it to me, give me the heads high.
I was like, yo, what is that? What is that? And I just remember, and I was just like, it was the best time of my life. And I was just like, I wanted to talk to you, and I was like, I can't talk to him, man. But like, I was like, I was so proud. I was telling my boys that I was like, yo, that dude's from my building, yo. Yo, he's like, he killed that shit, yo. And I was just like, yo, that motherfucker killed that shit. But I never forgot that. But anyway, moving forward in some of the clubs, there was Buddha Bar, right?
Yeah.
There was. Mm-hmm. I never got into Bob's. I never got into Mecca.
Bob's on
Bob's Salon.
Yeah.
In the Lower East Side.
On Elbridge. You didn't get in
Bob's? It was a hole in the wall, right?
Yeah. How come you didn't get in?
They would never let me in. They would just.
That's crazy. You know what?
I didn't think of it as that kind of place.
I used to roll with like 5 or 6 Ethiopian girls just to get in.
No, it would be like me and like 3 dudes.
Right? I never thought of it as a place that was like. I always thought you just walked in.
But it was so small. This would be so crowded.
Sunday nights, right? Sunday nights?
I've DJed there a couple of times. They just pay like $50.
Yeah, definitely. I'm surprised even 50.
They used to pay you 50 to DJ.
But I love those places. I know. I love those places.
Those are the spots.
Yeah.
Yeah, I never got into that Den of Thieves.
Don't worry about it.
Don't worry about it.
Actually, that was like the first spot I heard Mark Ronson spin at.
No, it was cool. But it's still.
He wasn't even Mark Ronson at the time. He was like Mark Spark.
Yeah, you
Mark
might be
the
right.
Spark or some shit like that. Yeah.
But then he found out there was another Mark the Spark.
Our Mark the Spark. Yeah, from Brand New's manager. And then there was, I never even heard of Don Hills.
Yeah, that's a legend.
On Greenwich.
That's a legendary spot.
Really?
Fuck, Madonna used to hang
out. Dude, really? Thursday nights at Don Hills was my, like, sanctuary. I mean, when I look back on, like, all the different clubs I used to like to go to, that one really is high on my list.
What were they playing in there?
So, Don Hills just playing a lot of shit.
Sunday nights used to be the hip hop night.
Yeah.
Well, it was different nights. They had a Sunday night hip hop. They had a Monday night hip hop. They had Thursday night, like he was saying, that was really, really big. And then the rest of the nights, they had like punk rock.
They had Misshapes, which was a big party that Madonna went to and stuff. The party that I used to go to was Frankie, the guy who did Soul Kitchen.
Frankie Gleason.
Yeah. He did a night at Don Hills that was kind of just all over the place, genre wise.
I never went, but I remember that party.
What night was that?
Oh my god, Thursdays. It was so fun. He doesn't know how to mix. Like no one ever cared. That was always like
because he always played quality.
He always played amazing records.
He did Soul Kitchen as well.
Yeah,
right?
He did Soul Kitchen, and he would play. I would watch him. He would play a record at Don Hills, go dance on the floor. And you hear the record end, then you just run back and grab another record. And I thought it was so cool. There's certain people that would be like, that's not real DJing or whatever.
He played dope records.
And I was like, that was like my heavy. I mean, I still collect records, unfortunately.
Jules and Julian, they used to do the party over at Donnell's.
Yeah, that's true. Jules was a really dope DJ.
Really dope party.
I mean, these are a lot of clubs before you started going out. Yeah, definitely. But I mean, I wish even at the time when I could go out, like
you didn't go out in high school.
No.
Okay.
I was trying to make Tribe Called Quest beats in my crib and shit like that. Indochine on
Lafayette.
Bill Spector party. He used to do some shit on the weekends.
Yeah. Definitely. And then these are just legendary clubs that I obviously never went to, but like Palladium. I know nothing about, but everyone would talk about that.
Yeah, well, you didn't watch Club. You didn't watch Club MTV.
I mean, no. I was just like, I didn't have cable probably at the time.
I just had regular Club MTV shit. Was at the Palladium.
I had Palladium, and to this day I regret this. I've never been to the Tunnel. I've never been there. Yeah. I've never was able to get into Life.
You're young.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm starting to think about it. I'm like, damn.
I'm fucking old.
I was never gotten. I've
Life
never
was
been
amazing. Was Life was it Monday nights?
Monday nights, it was Thursday nights. It was a lot of nights.
But a lot of Sunday nights. Life is like the beginning
of bottle service, right?
Yeah, so it's hard for me because I really didn't like the bottle service era. I don't have no attachment to it whatsoever, even though I worked in it.
Was that like the first
those kind of the first? But when life is sort of, they had that VIP room.
It was the first real
celebrity. But people still
they had like three VIP
rooms. They still had dance floors though. That's the thing. It was like, yeah. I remember when there was one club that opened up that I used to work at, and it was on Wednesday nights, and probably 2005. It was the first time I ever walked into a new club, first night, like kind of excited, and I was just like there's tables covering the whole dance floor.
Right.
And that was when I was just like, this is out of control. You know, like, what's the point?
You know, Nightlife went through a little phase where they were taking a lot of people's cabarets because the fucking mayor.
That's true.
Yeah, that's right.
So
yeah.
A lot of spaces were like, they were getting run up on. Yeah, they were. No, they were just like trying to be dickheads because they were like, oh, we want to contain people being out on the streets at 4 o'clock. We get a lot of complaints and blah, 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 blah.
Right, right.
So they would fuck with anybody that had like music playing.
Mm-hmm.
And that was the culture of fucking New York. And
the tables, actually, I noticed from working in engineering is that in order to get your permit, you had to have a floor plan that showed like dinner style seating.
Exactly. Right,
so when the police department and fire department would raid a club, it had to match the floor plan. If it didn't match the floor plan, it'd get violated.
Done deal.
For those who don't know what we're talking about, in New York, you get a liquor license and you can open a bar or lounge. But to actually have a club, you needed the cabaret license to have people dancing. Right. Or technically,
music and
dancing. I think it's from the 1920s, like a relic of prohibition.
Very, very, very old.
You couldn't have like one leg, like people couldn't have one leg above, like there had to be one. I don't know, there's something about like everyone had to be sitting or standing, there couldn't be one leg up,
at any time
or some shit like that. I don't know what the fuck they were talking about, but like PM would have, like, there was a lot of clubs at that time that didn't have cabaret, and they used to have like. A light, like a police siren.
When the fire people come
in,
right?
They would have a siren, not a siren, but the different color bulb, different police lights underneath the DJ booth. And when you saw that red light come on, you had to lower the volume from like 9 to like 3 or 2.
Right.
But do you remember like when that would happen? I remember when that would happen, and then the promoter would run up and be like, "Yo, they're coming."
Yeah.
And then everyone would get restless, and then they would leave, and you could like
then you had to play the best record out,
and it would, people would go crazy. It was kind of actually amazing for a DJ.
It was kind of dope.
Yeah, it was like a reset button.
But it was just nerve wracking because you just didn't know if they were gonna shut down the night or if it was just like a routine check or if they'd leave or not.
Right.
So like as we enter the late 90s and 2000s, and it goes into the bottle service era, right? There was like. What do you think was the biggest mega club that changed everything? Like
for the worse, you mean?
Yeah. Because I'm going to list a couple. There was the Park, which I love.
I like the Park, yeah.
I like the Park, and they had that special little upstairs joint. And I think that's actually one of the first times I saw Mark Ronson. And then there was Central Fly.
Yeah, Central Fly was great.
Central Fly was still a dance club.
Yeah, it was a dance club, yeah.
And then there was Spa.
Spa. Yeah, Spa was dope, but I don't think it was really too much of... Like bottle service, it was still like you were still in the mix. You were still able to flow.
Yeah.
I think the bottle service thing really kind of went into effect in the mid-2000s.
Definitely.
It was more like 2005, 2006. That's when it really, really
What clubs were the ones that you think that changed it, that really just changed the whole
thing? I don't think it was really clubs. I think it was just the attitude of having that fucked up the zone for everybody because it was like a lot of these different clubs couldn't compete with.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's before it used to be, you know, it just became very, what's the word for it?
Uptight?
A very bad aura. Like the aura became very,
showboating.
It was like,
oh yeah, you're talking about the
pretentious.
Pretentious,
that's the word.
But like people competing on how many bottles someone's buying and stuff like that.
Not so much. It became snobby because it was like New York never really been about like even from the great clubs from back in the days and the Shelter and shit like that.
Yeah.
You would have a millionaire dude. Dancing to somebody that was just homeless 2 minutes ago.
Yeah.
You never knew.
But
they were all dancing on the same dance floor, same level.
Right.
You know, you had that type of synergy. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? That's what made the clubs dope.
Mm-hmm.
And the fact of the matter was, it became of, before you can even walk in here, I need a credit card.
Exactly.
Like, what the fuck are you talking about?
Yeah. I think, so for me, I was DJing at Bungalow 8, every Saturday or something. And when it was the only club on 27th Street. And, It was fun. It was like, you know, it was hard to get into. Everyone knows that. It has a reputation and famous people, blah, blah, blah. But there was also a lot of regular New York people, downtown kids or whatever, who weren't spending any money. And you could smoke weed openly in there. So that was like a big draw. And musically, I had complete freedom. So I was into it. But the club became kind of the model, I think, for all these other places to kind of try and copy. And that block became the epicenter of kind of expensive partying, So it was like Marquee followed, then Home, then Guest House, then
Kane was there,
Bed, right? And Kane, and
Spotlight. And,
yeah.
No, was it Spotlight?
Yeah, that
was
Stereo.
Spotlight.
Or
Spotlight. Remember that big
Spotlight in the middle? Yeah, totally.
Yeah.
And then up the, and then one block up, they opened the Miami Club. They had whatever.
Pink Elephant? Or?
There was a Pink Elephant.
Crowbar.
Yeah. And Crowbar. Yeah. Crowbar. All these clubs were two blocks of each other.
Yeah.
And there's no way that you can have all of these clubs going. And it was like back then, it was still weeknight culture.
Right.
So they clubs were going off every night of the week. And to fill up all these clubs and have them make money, and they're at this point in the mid 2000s, they're paying astronomical rent. To keep this going, you've got to cater to wealthy people, bankers, hedge fund people. These people are not fun. They're not cool. You don't want to be around. I mean, I'm not trying to put, like, I'm sure there's a nice banker out there somewhere, but in general, this is not what club culture is about. Like, club culture is trying to escape that
and
stuff.
And then it just became like a dick swinging contest.
Exactly,
after that.
Exactly.
Just, you know, who spent this or who's going
to
be there.
Who's going to get more sparklers brought to their
table. Like, I think we went from like late 90s to mid 2000s, and we may have skipped some of the clubs that kind of mixed all that.
Oh, definitely.
I think Lotus was one of those clubs.
Lotus. Yeah,
where you had this real mixiness going on, but you still had that prominent VIP with the bottle service.
Right.
But I mean, that was kind of like aspirational. Like, you wanted to get up.
You know what? I think there was always, not in every club, but a lot of clubs, there was always bottle service, but it was kept on the side. And you didn't really, as a DJ, you were like, those are the people that are sitting.
Yeah, but
you
I don't really pay attention to them, right? I don't really think that it was like more VIP. I think that was just like the promoters and they hosted tables.
Yeah, right.
The VIP, I think, really started with that velvet rope outside. Like, it's like, the only way you're going to be able to get in here is if you spend $5,000 for a table. And that's like, yo, I don't even drink.
Right.
Fuck am I doing spending $5,000 for a table? And I'm like, you know.
But you mentioned Pangea earlier, Crooked.
Yeah.
Pangea was like one of the first clubs.
I think Pangea and Serafina, they brought a lot of that European culture to the city.
Totally.
I mean, remember Eugene's?
Oh yeah.
That was one of them. One of the first clubs that...
Eugene's by the bridge.
Eugene's on 20.
Oh, 20.
Noah, Jason and Noah, one of the first spots that they opened up.
Was that and then what do you call it? Was that was that Sweet 16?
That was another spot. Sweet 16. That used to be Rebar.
Sweet 16 was a night at Rebar.
Totally.
Yeah, and Rebar, that was dope.
It was Rebar first, and then shut it down, and it became Sweet
16. You're right.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
What was the party at Rebar?
I DJ'd it. It was Mark Ronson started.
Yeah.
It.
Yep.
Then
what was it called? It wasn't called Sweet 16.
Was it a Tuesday night?
It was Wednesday.
Was it?
Maybe Tuesday or Wednesday.
It was Tuesday.
Maybe Tuesday. I got to open up a couple of times. It was so fun.
Big Frank party.
Arson. DJ Arson used to DJ there.
Exactly. Yeah.
LePaul. Yeah.
Exactly.
Big shout to Eric LePaul.
Yeah. That was fun. That was fun. Yeah.
And then there was what do you call it? We met at Light on 50-something Street.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And then there was what do you call it? Pangea Rehab at the Time Cafe. There was Joe's Pub.
Yep.
There was Suede.
Suede was a good party.
That was 23rd, right?
Yeah,
23rd.
Yeah.
Six and seven.
And then there was One, and then there was Show.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And
Cessa.
Yeah.
PM.
Right.
Yeah.
And Cielo, of course, and the APT, which later became the Meatpacking District, started blowing up around
APT opened up, and then Cielo opened up pretty like maybe 2 years after. Mm-hmm. And for a long time, it was those two clubs were like the oasis for people who wanted to hear good music or whatever. Would go to
By the way, the part at Rebar was Sweet Thing.
Sweet Thing.
Yeah, that's it. Yep, that's right.
And then PM was actually, I came up with like kind of Unique and Kiki, you know.
Right.
I think they started like the first Wednesday hip hop party, or like a mix of party, and then it was the first time hip hop was played at Pangea, and then they had it. It was from Show, and then they had Show, at the same time, and then they opened PM, and then PM was like, I just remember that time spinning at PM and then having just all of these clubs just starting to open up in the meatpacking district.
Yeah.
And it just became the new area, and then everyone was kind of leaving, what was that, the Marquee, that one block?
Yeah, the 27th Street.
The 27th Street.
Club Row. We used to call it Club Row. Yeah.
And then you had a residency out there at a home and guest house, right?
Uh-huh.
And I remember going there almost every Wednesday with Sean Perry to go and listen to Ellie. And he would be playing like everything from like U2 to like, you know, into like the new hip-hop.
So do you was the music good? Because when I think back at those days, I'm like, oh, I must have been playing terrible music.
No, for us, it was like, yo, he just played, you know, like, Mysterious Ways. And we would just be like, damn, like, no one's playing this shit.
Yeah, I remember going to that night, and it was really refreshing. Yeah. We're like, yo, this dude is making it interesting, and he's playing to, like, you know, the this worst weird crowd.
Yeah, and it was just, it was so good. The music was so good, and it was so, like, you know, you don't scratch much, but then when you did scratch, we were like, yeah, that was pretty fresh. Because you would do like a jigga jigga and then
drop
something.
I never really got the hang of it.
Yeah, but it was just dope. And it was one of those parties. And then we would go to Lotus to hear Goldfinger.
Thank you.
And then it was just like, we would just take notes and study. And it really kind of like shaped all of us when we were coming up in those years and stuff like that. And you always had these great, I don't know how to, like you had these setup records. So you would drop like Ashford and Simpson, like solid as a rock.
Gotcha.
And then, you know, we build it up. And then you drop like So Seductive.
Oh, nigga, do you know what this is? We're like, oh.
I remember the first time I heard that, you played solid as a rock. And then we build it up. And then I was like looking, I think it was with Sean Perry. Or I don't know who I was with. And I was like, yo, what is he doing right now? And it was like, we build it up. And then you just drop Tony Ayo, So Seductive. And it was just like, oh my. And the room just erupted. And I was just like, yo, man. And it was like, at the time, I think I was calling him like Setup Records. And I'm like, yo, I got to have one of those because I don't have one of those. We're just like totally kind of like, you just like throw, like you just kind of stop the room for a second.
Right.
And everyone's a little shocked and stuff. And then they just kind of listen like, what's going on? And they're like, oh shit, like this is dope. And then the energy starts building up, and then you just take them and you just turn them and stuff like that.
Right.
But I was just wondering, like, you know, like where did you start just like kind of messing with those kind of setup records and stuff like that?
I've been doing it for a while as far as that. I just like to well, with that type of stuff, it's just like getting something that's familiar is really, really good because if they don't know where you're going, just trying to do something a little unpredictable. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Just like getting everybody to go one way. It's kind of like diversionary to a certain degree.
Yeah, yeah.
But it's just good to have a good follow-up if you do a record like that. Just good to have a good introduction.
But it's like you were saving.
You did feel like more like you were a chess player.
Yeah.
Because a lot of the dudes who do shit that's like wildly different like that, they set it up using the mic. And you didn't really talk on the mic.
No, I don't talk on the mic at all. And like it's funny that you said chess because I'm looking, when I play music, I play a record, but I'm thinking 2-3 moves. Definitely. What's going to be the next move?
Yeah.
What, you know, Murphy's Law, if this record fucks up on me or this record scratches or this, you know, I have to have that momentum where I don't lose the room. So I'm thinking in bunches like, 2 or 3 records instead of thinking of 15 minutes. I'm thinking of 2 or 3 records at a time. If that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
There's that old jab, jab.
I remember being in a room with, I remember who I would be. I would be with Mel DeBarge, and we'd be listening, we'd be wilding out, and you'd be playing like songs like prime time, like you said, Ellie. He'd be playing like Chaka Khan, I Know You, I Live You. And I would never hear that. And
yeah, but those are primetime records. It's just, you know.
For me, but
like,
I've never heard
of
those.
If you love
records,
music,
you know? Yeah.
Those are primetime records. Yeah, so it's
but,
not, yeah, yeah. You
but
know.
The next day I would go to Rock and Soul. I'd be like, yo, you have that one Chaka Khan song, and I Know You, I Live You. And I would sing it for them. They'd be like, yeah, yeah, I got those. And we would start building. Yeah, I would just be like, I would
it's
just hear those in prime time.
That was before Shazam, right?
Yeah.
So you'd be in a room, you'd hear a song you had never heard. It could be an R&B album cut. And everybody's like, what the fuck is this?
Yep.
And you'd be like, I'm going to go ask the DJ. And I would go to that booth in Lotus. Like, you know, you got to go like through that other room and come up a flight of stairs, and I'd knock on the door, and I'd be like, excuse me. And Goldie would be like, oh, that's Tony Braxton. Take this ring. That's Tony Braxton? Oh, my God. Shit is crazy.
Hey, yo, there was an interview with Funkmaster Flex, and they asked him, was there any DJ he was ever scared of that was going to take his spot? First he said, nah. Then he was like, yo, wait a minute. There's one DJ that scared me. It was Goldfinger.
Wow.
Well, he didn't actually say that.
He said that. He was like, yo, there was only one DJ, Goldfinger. He was doing Envy. I was like, yo, this guy's going to take my spot. You never saw that interview?
Nah, I didn't see that. Shout out to Flex. Shout out to
Flex. This Goldie being political right now.
But in his mind, you know what this is.
Oh, what do you call it? Speaking of shit that other DJs have said about other DJs, we recently had a Shecky on the podcast, and yeah. Shecky mentioned DJ AM.
Yeah.
And DJ AM speaking about Eli Escobar, and he actually said something to the effects of, you know, with all the success that DJ AM had and everything, the fame and everything, mm-hmm. the one DJ he always admired and wanted to live the life and be, and he would give up everything just to be this, to have this DJ's life, right?
Yeah, yeah, this life.
Was Eli Escobar.
Wow.
Yeah. That's big.
I mean, that's...
And I think he was... What was he saying? He was fascinated. He just was really an admirer.
Just the way he was living his life. Like, it was very, like, content. It was, like, nothing crazy. It was basic, like... It was just a dope lifestyle to him.
To have like a girlfriend, to be produced, to have the freedom to produce what he wanted, to DJ what he wanted, and then to tour playing whatever he wanted.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And he really was a fan of that lifestyle.
Well, that's both of them, actually.
Yeah.
To me, that's how I feel about both of these guys.
With Moma and Ellie.
Well, I feel like I've always looked up to Goldie and Ellie because mm-hmm. I was always like, I want to DJ like Goldie. But then I would watch Ellie be... At home doing like some mid-level commercial party, and then I would hear about Ellie being in Atlantic City. I was like, whoa, he's got a casino gig. And then I would hear him in like the little rooms, you know, playing like amazing music, and I was like, this dude's got the whole gamut of gigs.
Yeah,
like that's really, really impressive, you know.
And you signed, you were on Dexstar, yeah?
Yeah.
And no, that wasn't you guys yeah, laughing yeah. I didn't do anything.
And then
no, AM was like really cool because he was like really looking out for the working DJ.
yeah, yeah, yeah.
Right, because he spent a lot of time being one himself, and never really veered from that as far as like format wise. Like he never like put out his own music, or you know, people, he had a reputation of being a really skilled DJ. Everyone knows that. Mm-hmm. But in general,
understatement.
Yeah, exactly. He was playing music to people on the, you know, a basic. I really want to make sure that be clear that I'm not using that as an insulting word.
Yeah.
But a basic crowd, not like a house music night or a,
like, know, mainstream. We're just gonna say a basic music pedigree.
Yeah, exactly. And there's nothing like wrong with that. Right? I mean, we yeah. all that's what. Yeah. We, yeah. So he, even though he was making lots of money and he was a celebrity, he still was kind of a working DJ.
Right.
Right. Because he had to know all the new songs. He had to make sure he played them at the right time. All the stuff that we do. And but he was like, the first thing that he really wanted to do when he got successful was like bring a lot of other people with him. Mm-hmm. Which was pretty amazing, right?
That he admired.
Yeah.
That he liked.
Yeah, exactly. And
because a lot of the people on Dexstar were people that he liked and were cool with.
Yeah, exactly.
And they were homies, kind of. And
I think all of them. I don't think there was anyone.
Mostly like West Coast dudes, except for you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And like Pace Rock.
Pace Rock, yeah.
Oh, Jazzy Jeff. And that's,
oh, yeah.
That was later, right?
Yeah, that was a little later. For like a quick second, yeah.
Yeah, and even like he just really brought people that he loved, admired in some way, or just either was really good homies with, and he's like, yo, right. Like now it's time to like spread the wealth a little
yeah,
bit.
Yeah, exactly.
You know what I mean? Like
exactly.
I'm getting these opportunities, and I can give some of these opportunities to you, and everyone could get paid.
Didn't Rock the Con also say that he would like ask you and Rock tech advice on for like production?
Yeah, I mean, Ableton, I think things like that. Yeah, he did. Yep. He wanted to, you know, try to make music, whatever. But anyway, but so that was his thing, and he did a you know, he got me out there. But quickly I realized that I didn't really want to do those kind of parties. Yeah. I didn't want to do casinos and whatever. But it was a really good experience. You know, I think as a DJ, I never look down on any, you know, like whether it's playing for $50 or for $3,000 or whatever. Like, any experience you get makes you a better DJ, even if you veer on another path musically. You know, I think all the time I spent just playing five nights a week in clubs as an anonymous, you know, DJ, just trying to play all the songs everyone wanted to hear or whatever, it really informed the way I play now that I actually can do my own parties and get my own crowd and stuff. Like, I think I'd be a way worse DJ if I hadn't spent so many years doing that other stuff, you know?
So we booked a DJ from the UK a couple of weeks ago, Jyoti, at our Wednesday night party that Ellie and I do at LeBain. And she's a big fan of Ellie. Knows Ellie as a dance music producer, as a dance music DJ. But at Dance Dance Dance, our party it's called Dance Dance Dance. It's not a house music party. No. It's about dance music. And you can dance to pretty much anything. And at some point during the night, we switch up the tempo and Ellie dropped it down to 95 BPM, played dance hall, played a little hip hop. And this girl from London was like, Ellie plays bashment? She could not believe it.
Wow.
She
What's was bashment?
Like, that's how they that's call the
dance
word hall.
For dance hall. Okay.
She's like, he plays dance hall and hip hop? Like, my mind is blown. And I was like, this guy's a hip hop DJ.
Yeah.
Like, a working stiff, like all of us. Like you said, five nights a week.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Lugging crates.
Yeah.
Cataloging
shit. Right. Well, there's been such a shift in the culture where, like, a DJ can make, like in dance music especially, a DJ can make one record, the record blows up, and the only way they can really make money is to hit the road, right? And so they're like, all right, I get like an hour and a half set, and I'm just going to find out what all the top records are on Beatport or whatever. And, you know, pretty easy to figure out how to beat match quantized 123 BPM records, right, for an hour and a half.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And just play one, then another, then one, then another, and then you're done. So I think it always catches people by surprise when somebody can actually really DJ and have those instincts to like drop the tempo down and play different kinds of music, and you know.
Well, you mentioned this on Twitter, actually. I think it was right after you went on tour in Europe.
Uh-huh.
And you said, I don't know if you were depressed, but you did a whole tour in Europe and it was all 2-hour headlining sets.
Yeah.
And you are so, I mean, I guess I'm the same way, because we have conversations on the podcast about this a lot. And we all grew up, and I was in the clubs in the early 2000s. We were spinning from 10 o'clock to 4 a.m., sometimes 5 a.m. if it was popping. So I'm used to really conducting a whole night, saving and having this catalog of music where I could go, like you said, classics, reggae, a little this and that, and really show everyone my cards. And nowadays in Vegas, even when I headline, you know, I spend from 12:30 to 2:30, and it's not enough.
Yeah.
And the club wants me to do one thing from 12:30 to 2:30, and it's sometimes when I analyze from 12:30 to 2:30 what can be done, I'm just like, if you want me to just come on and play hits, and play everything that's new, and do what everyone's doing, then you might as well just bring in another, like a 12-year-old kid or like a 15-year-old or like a really young kid to just play for an hour and play all the new shit.
It makes you feel sort of interchangeable, right?
Yeah, and then so it's like one of those things where I could really curate the whole night and do the whole night and really give the crowd an experience in 6 hours. Mm-hmm. And so when you came back from your tour, you said you were almost depressed but you did like a 6-hour a gig at one point, and then you said like you felt revitalized because there were so many layers to Eli Escobar, but on this tour you're only able to like show one layer, and then you're not really able to show everything.
That's the thing that I envy the most about them right now, because they have like an experience party, and that's what I like to call them. It's like one of those things where you can go there and just be like, I would have never thought to play that, or yo, he actually got that off. Like, it's like one of those, and it doesn't necessarily have to be, oh, that was a hip hop record. That just could be any record. This could be any record, and you just find yourself like, they're going there, and it's not. It's geared to a like a more savvy, more, I wouldn't say intelligent, but more experienced crowd. A more
open-minded.
A very, it's not like you're dumbing your crowd down. And that's, you know, right. You can show the strength of two very intelligent DJs and then they give you the gamut of good music. Mm-hmm. That's, I really appreciate that.
Yeah, I mean, I always, when I was like, you know, just grinding and playing, you know, the clubs, doing the circuit, I always looked up to, like I was like, damn, I want to be like Rich Medina or Bobbito or the guys that do Body and Soul because they have their night and people actually come to see them because of the music they play.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And I was just like, but I'll never be like that because I'm not like out there, like, you know, like how do you even promote a party? But it all kind of just weirdly fell into my lap. So,
but it's funny you mentioned those names because those are like, for me, the same names. I used to look up to Rich, Rich Medina, because he could play anything.
Right.
Even though he, you know, ultimately specialized, he could play everything. Spinner. Play everything. Yeah. He specialized.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Stretch could also play anything.
Yeah.
You know, he's known for hip hop, but he can play anything.
Right.
Tony Touch, you know, Goldfinger. I was like, those, for me, those were the five guys that, like, they each have, like, their strong suits or, like, their favorite joints they like to hit, but they could play anything.
Right. But, I mean, it was, like, APT, the first time I ever, so when APT opened up, the first, one of the first moves they made was to give Bob Monday nights. And we had been there together on a weekend just to see the spot. And I was like, it's cool. I don't know. I mean, APT is one of those places we look back on fondly because of the music they played and also kind of what it represented during this particular time, right? Mm-hmm. But the room itself wasn't that great. Right. It was just a really narrow bar.
Right.
So the first night, the first Monday night Bob has, he's like, yo, Ellie, I'm sick. Can you do it?
On the opening night.
Yeah, on the opening night. I was like, you know, it's gonna be crazy. And it was a snowstorm and literally it was me and the bartenders the whole night. Wow. And I was just like, I mean, a snowstorm is a, you know, an obstacle, but in general I was like, not one person came here. Like, Bob's really got his work cut out for right. for like a month later it was like the hottest Monday night. Yeah. Like, especially amongst a certain group of people.
So what year was this?
Probably 2001 or something. So to me that was just like, I couldn't believe it, like that he could actually just word of mouth. I mean, he didn't have, there wasn't Facebook, whatever. Mm-hmm. Word of mouth, he packed that place out on Monday night. So that always seemed like kind of a good goal to kind of like strive towards, to be able to do that, you know.
But it's also interesting when you start to travel and especially when you go to other continents and mm-hmm. they're like, so what kind of DJ are you? What kind of music do you play?
Yeah, yeah.
Well, you know, hip hop, R&B, dancehall, soca, house.
Yeah.
And they're like, so do you play everything? I'm like, yeah. Doesn't everyone play everything?
It's not as normal there in other places, right, as it is in New York.
Definitely not in Europe.
Right. No.
Definitely not in Europe.
Yeah. I did this place in London called Brixton Jam. And it was like a Thursday night. I didn't charge, like, it was like a low fee gig. But I was like, I'll play. Like, this is weird. The way my mind works, I'll be like, my negotiating is, I'll play for less if I can DJ longer. So I was like, yo, let me play from the 10 to 4 or 5, whatever, and I'll play.
You get to set the table and do what
just,
you need to do.
Yeah, it's just more fun. The more fun I'm going to have, the less money I need.
Right.
So I played this place, and a big crowd came out, and then at one point, I had enough vodka sodas in me that I was playing Mary J. Blige and Brand Nubian and all that stuff.
Wow.
Because whenever I get a little drunk, that's where I go to, because that music is mm-hmm. just so important to me.
Wow.
Yeah.
I feel like a lot of times once I'm drunk, I'm like, now I'm going to play the music of my youth or whatever.
Yeah.
And a lot of the London people were like kind of like that to me. Like, they couldn't believe that I would change genres up from like just disco and house. Yeah, and it was like,
did it upset you? Or
I mean, I was drunk enough that I didn't really care. And I was like, you could go, because there's enough people still dancing, and I got a dance hall set coming up, so you're not gonna be happy for a while.
I think really, from that standpoint, New York crowds of people who came up even before my time, right? Like in the 70s, in the 80s, in the 90s, in the 2000s, some of the most well-rounded music listeners in the world.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yep.
And I feel I can say it now because for the past 4 or 5 years, I've been traveling the entire planet. And every country I go to, I'm like, oh, this set is not working.
Yeah,
let me like rewind and go back to the regular program.
Mm-hmm.
But when I come back to New York, even different from other parts of the United States, like, you just play everything and you never run out of music. It's incredible.
Yeah.
You can play old and classic from six genres. Mm-hmm. And new, old, new classics from six genres.
Do you feel the same way when you approach a night? I mean, if you had a whole night, do you, probably you, not you, Moma, but like any of you guys, Goldfinger, even Neva or whatever, like you'd rather spend 6 hours
every, and control no matter the night. What. Yeah, I'll definitely.
Is that
would.
The same for you or not? You're
if,
fine?
If I can play a 1 hour if I'm playing with like-minded guys. Like if I'm playing with guys that are going to pull.
Oh, yeah.
You know what
yeah,
I mean?
Yeah,
or if
yeah,
they
yeah.
have the same type of aesthetic.
Yeah.
Not they don't necessarily have to play the same records I'm playing, but just have that same mindset
mm-hmm.
that, you know, I'm going to go in my bag. I'm gonna get some shit off. You right. know what I mean? Like you got to have that type of. That's why I normally don't play with too many other DJs because a lot of people have different motives. And my thing is mm-hmm. the party.
Right.
It's not even about me getting off sometimes. It's more about the party than
yeah.
anything else.
Yeah, yeah.
Nev, I mean, Mo, you probably don't want to spend a 6 hour set ever, right? Or you don't?
No, I wouldn't mind. I feel like I've been doing my own parties for several years now that I'm spoiled.
Uh-huh.
So I have to know what I'm getting into if I'm playing for 6 hours. But I could DJ my parties for 6 hours without a problem. The reason why I don't is because there's more of a community thing now.
Yeah.
If I went around the country DJing everyday people by myself, everybody mm-hmm. would be like, yo, why is he hogging the set?
Right,
like,
right.
There's
right.
X amount of up-and-coming yeah. DJs. Uh-huh. There's like vets in every market. Like I feel like I need to put everybody on. So it's more of a community thing. But
yeah.
I would love to play 6 hours.
I mean, I feel like I always feel weird. Like you land in a city and... Like Berlin is a really good example. Mm-hmm. Berlin is buck wild because I'll land in Berlin at like, you know, 11 a.m. right, and the promoter will pick me up and be like, all right, so maybe put you on early tonight, like maybe like 5:30 a.m. or something. Like that's early to them because they mm-hmm. go nonstop, and I'll be like, I have to just like.
That's stay tomorrow. Away.
That's tomorrow.
That's
like,
tomorrow.
Like I'm excited to DJ. Just let me DJ. Like, and then.
I know. This is welcome to New York. This is the World Podcast in yes. New York City. Thank you.
And then you show up to the club. I usually try to get there an hour early to listen to the opener or the DJ before me. You get there and it's been going on for mad long. And it's like in full swing.
Yeah.
I feel like I'm not like, oh man, I can't wait to grab this crowd. I feel like I'm at a disadvantage.
Right.
Because I didn't get a chance to
absorb.
Yeah. Yeah. To feel the crowd, to watch people yeah. come in and see what they're into and.
Yeah, it's like you know, you're doing recon. You yeah, have to do recon.
Yeah.
Even
yeah.
like if I'm playing at a spot and I've never played that spot before, I'm going to that spot the week before
mm-hmm.
just to get yeah, an yeah. idea who's going to be there, what, you know, the ratio is,
mm-hmm.
you know, what the vibe is when I'm not there so I know what to bring and what to fill in.
Right.
You know what I mean?
And I think one thing that maybe like the four of us have in common, including you, Crooked, is we read the room, right?
So we don't never, have these. Never too, yeah.
We don't have these sets. And of course. DJ Neva.
Sorry about that. My bad. You're not a crowd reader, Neva.
Exactly. We don't necessarily have like sets that yeah. are prepared. So if you don't warm up, your brain isn't warmed up.
I
you know, songs don't come to you
yeah,
as fast.
I agree.
Nowadays I get extreme anxiety about openers and closers and just switching laptops.
Oh, God.
And it's just like I switch my laptop and I'm set up. And then a manager is in my ear saying, this table's here, this table's there, and that table's there. And then automatically I'm in like, all right, I'm working for the club. I got to do what they got to do. I'll keep the energy up. But at no point, and I always say this, like I'm literally a whore. I'm at no point am I like, I can't wait to play this record that I like. I'm just like, yo, what are the necessary records? What do I need to do to keep everyone here, to make the club money? And it just becomes that focus. You know, yeah, throughout right. the whole thing, and I become very numb, and right. I actually, and it's one of those things where I want to open the whole, I want to open and close, and I want to do the whole night. But as soon as I start doing that, or if I ask the clubs to do that, there are these opener and closer DJs that aren't going to work.
So this brings me a question I yeah. have for you guys, since I don't really DJ these, like, you know, is it open format? Is that like
yeah, open for you.
Whatever. So I can remember like being, you know, when I started DJing in 93 and in my senior year of high school. And then right away in college, that following fall, I guess I thought I was decent enough to do parties because I was doing parties in school. And I don't ever remember having that feeling of like, oh man, there's 3 hours left. What am I going to play? Mm. It was like just endless amounts of good music.
You didn't think about
it. You know, it was like, yeah, it was like, the new stuff that was coming out was amazing. Not that I think the quality of music is bad now, but I just didn't. And it would seem like you could play a lot of stuff, like you could play like album cuts from Brand New Me or album cuts from
the Gangstar.
What was that first? The first Tribe album had on Footprints. That was like a record you play in the club. Nobody knows that song now. Like, and
you guys were playing that in the club and
Footprints. Footprints was a club record. Yeah, wow. That was a club record. And then when the snare dropped, wild out. Oh yeah,
really?
When that beat dropped,
that's their best song. I think it's their best song.
That was a big dance
floor. Yeah,
when that jump dropped, they used to wild out to that shit.
That's so crazy.
Yeah, Lucky Lucien used to rip.
Yeah, Lucky Lucien. So and then like even up and so then when I came back from school and was doing clubs, I remember, you know, it was like things started to get a little bit more like the late 90s was when like Bad Boy was like the influence of Bad Boy was spreading, right? Like the Beatnuts would put out records that had Shakers or like all these little things that was like records were getting more clubby or whatever, but it was still really good music. And then I can and then fast forward to like my last days kind of as a basic like a open format club DJ, like that casino gig. I can remember that feeling of like, oh my god, what am I gonna play? Like, how am I gonna make it to the end of the night? Because so many records you could only play the chorus and then people would lose interest by the time. Some records you would only play the chorus. I bet that's still happening, right? And
more so now.
But what's worse is that it's new records.
Yeah.
So that's still happening right now.
So it'd be like the biggest records. Everyone's requesting that record. Yeah. Everyone's waiting for you to drop it.
As soon as the first
chorus goes and it goes into the verse,
they're bored already.
It's done.
You gotta get out of
crazy.
It.
Crazy. Yeah. That's crazy.
Yeah.
And for us, that's even harder because these are like the ammunition, which would be the music that is given to us.
Yeah, it's over in 20 seconds.
It's over in 20 seconds. Yeah, yeah. And another thing that like you were mentioning when you said you were DJing in the early 90s and you were like, how could I run out of music? I wasn't thinking about the 3 hours. It was because like you guys said, you guys were all about the music. You were collecting records for years and years and you were building this ammunition up and you were like studying the music. You know what was dope. By the time you got kind of started doing the clubs, you knew like like you had a wide catalog of music that you already had, whereas DJs nowadays don't have the catalog and they have the skills and they're just kind of going into the club.
And it's crazy because you had to play records and then you were playing the records a lot longer because you were playing vinyl.
Right. Yeah.
And then you were bringing them back. You were doing, you were showing a little bit more skill with that, but you were actually playing with less because it's a lot less than 100,000 records in your laptop. I know that for a fact. You know what I mean? So
And then, so you're playing playing two verses.
You had to be tactical. You had to be a little bit more tactical if you were good.
I mean, there was always that thing. I remember there were certain records where you would just play one little part of it to get to another record.
Right.
Mm-hmm. But there were records like Mona Lisa where you had to play till the end when the girl starts singing. Right. You know, like, so it went both ways. But yeah, you did play. I mean, sometimes now when I listen to like Ain't No Half Steppin', I'm like, I don't really know the third verse as well as I know the first two verses. And I realized because I never let that third verse play in the clubs, you know?
Right.
But yeah, you would play a lot. The songs would play for a lot longer, I think.
When you were doing I remember when we were mentioning Dexstar and I kind of like laughed a little bit and you're like, whoa, what's so funny? The whole thing is that during that time when you were on Dexstar and I was traveling, we were on the road constantly and it was such a grind, right? And I knew at that time you must have been like very like, damn, I'm so glad to be, have all these opportunities, but it must have been so draining. And a lot of us kind of hated DJing. We didn't hate DJing, but it was just so
because of the traveling,
and stuff like that.
Right.
And I was just wondering how that affected you. Cause I know in some cases with like guys that we know, like Rocktacon, it actually ended up like kind of fucking up, like just wearing him out and just having him want to take a break and like literally retire from DJing for a few years. You know what I mean?
Oh, it's interesting. Cause I haven't traveled since January 25th, 2019 because I had a daughter.
Nice. Congratulations.
Thank you. I wanted to obviously,
but during that Dexstar period, you know what I mean. You were on the road.
Well, so I'm about to take my first trip this weekend for the first time since January. And the other day I was in the park. I pulled up the Delta app and I was like, there's no outgoing flight for Saturday.
Mm-hmm.
And so I don't know, somebody messed up and I had to get a flight and it's more expensive now because they didn't do it early and blah, blah, blah. And I was just like, man, I hate traveling.
Yeah.
Like, I'm already, like, dreading this, and it's only, like, a real quick trip to Toronto. But it's just that part of it. Once you get to the city and you like, you know, for me at least, but the other thing, there's a difference, right? Because the Dexstar days, I didn't really like the music I was playing or the atmosphere of the clubs. I think I used to feel kind of like, when I was playing for Dexstar, when I was doing those gigs, I used to kind of feel like, why do they have me here?
Mm-hmm.
Like, playing the same records that everybody else plays. Maybe I can play them a little bit differently or a little bit better, but it didn't feel like, it didn't even feel like they knew who I was. Right. It was just like, you're a guy that's friends with DJ AM, or you're on Dexstar. Mm-hmm. Now when I travel, it's like the people that pick me up, they know my records. They've heard my sets on Boiler Room or whatever, and I know that they know the sound that I do, or like whatever, and that's why I'm there. So it's a very different experience. And the other parts of it are drag, but at the same time, you have to be a fool to complain about traveling the world for music, right?
Yeah, yeah. A little.
Goldie, there was a time when you were doing like every major party in New York, like every big club, every industry event. Did you then start traveling, or did you just withdraw?
No, I did both. I actually did both at the same time. I wanted to make it, well, a lot of the clubs started closing at the same time. That started happening. And then I started making my inroads. We're making a little bit more of a corporate push, I could say.
Right.
Just clean up the crowd a little bit, because it started getting a little weird, a little grimier towards that, you know, I guess you would say the t-shirt era, you know, like 2000.
It's like
2000 t-shirts. So it started getting a little, you know, so I started doing a little bit more like just different crowd for the most part. But New York's just changed so much, and it's more so New York is really felt the effects of this whole Disneyland type of situation. Like when they went to the 42nd and kind of like tried to squeegee everything out and make everything kind of like corporate, I guess you can say. It took a lot of the character away from New York. And a lot of people that were going out to clubs, it just didn't feel worth it anymore. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. People just like, you know what I mean? And then you had a lot of people that moved, a lot of transplants that's here. So they don't really know the culture of what New York is.
Right.
And that brings a whole different type of energy
mm-hmm.
to you know, where you congregate and when, you know.
And right. And that's why you have all these beer gardens in Brooklyn and Bed-Stuy. All these people move to Brooklyn and they think, well, this is how we hang out.
Yeah,
in
where
Pacific
we come
Northwest
from.
So let's bring whatever. It here. So let's just do it here, right? Yeah,
yeah. And it's a different mix.
I mean, I don't know the scene in New York, in Brooklyn right now. You know, me and Neva has been in Vegas
for like the past 15
I mean, New
years.
York, New York is just, it's wide open now. It's not like it used to be downtown.
Yeah.
Right? And then.
I think 9/11 had a lot to do with it. Mm-hmm. A lot. 9/11 kind of like, you couldn't go into the city for a little while after 9/11. And then after a while, it just like kind of got creepy to come into Manhattan to really kind of party. It was like a lull.
It took a while.
It took a long while. Like actually, Envy was like one of the few clubs that kind of opened up after 9/11. We were kind of like, our proximity to World Trade was pretty close. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like 15 blocks. But we were like the closest downtown club that started off. I'm like, yo, we got to get back to, you know, doing this party shit.
Right.
And then that kind of kicked off. And that was actually a great time in New York, because it was like everybody was New Yorkers.
Yeah, a lot of people say that. Yeah.
Everybody was New Yorkers. Everybody was together. Mm-hmm. And then the music. And even though it was like, it's ironic that we were all together in the music, New York was beefing. Everybody was beefing at that time. You had Nas and Ether. You had the Jay-Z takeover. You had, you know, the Fat Joe. Everybody, D-Block, Nas, Mobb Deep. Everybody was beefing. Yeah. So it was dope, but it was, the energy was there. And it felt like New York. You know what I mean?
That was probably like the most unified New York has ever felt after 9/11. Everyone was like together and shit like that. Yeah, like,
it was a good time. It was a real good time. It was a real good time.
What do you call it? I wanted to talk about, because I'm so curious about it, because me and Moma had this conversation about like Biggie having a ghostwriter. Before we go into that, during the 90s when Biggie was just everywhere, and you were DJing the parties, and you were DJing with him, and like what was, you know?
Well, to tell you the truth, I wasn't that hot when Biggie was out. Biggie was out. I was doing like mixtapes. I was still at the store.
Right.
I was doing my parties, but I wasn't that hot. Like the hot DJs around about that time was like Flex, because he just got on the radio, and then Stretch Armstrong was of course big, because he was on, you know, he was on fire.
It's Clark Kent already.
Clark Kent was all city. He was like one of the few DJs that was, he could do any party he wanted to. He was turning down 2 or 3 parties a night.
Kid Capri,
but Kid Capri wasn't really in the city. Yeah, in 94, 95. He was abroad.
He was traveling.
He was doing Def Jam. He was everywhere.
Yeah, that's true.
So you had like, you know, the mixtape guys were the guys that were really moving the needle at that point. And if you were on the radio, like Flex, you pretty much had law of the land. So when Biggie came out, it was more, if you was hot in the mixtapes, you were good. And when Biggie came out, it was like, it's kind of like a tidal wave, because he brought a lot of people that normally didn't go out to the parties, that were just like, no, I don't really party like that, whatever. He brought people out the hood to go see Biggie, because everybody knew a Biggie in their neighborhood. Everybody knew somebody like Biggie.
Right.
And then Biggie was kind of popular in Brooklyn, so it was like everybody knew Fat Chris. It was like one of those type of things.
Right.
Yo, Fat Chris. Yo. You know what I mean? It's like, he was like the mayor. You know what I mean? So it was like one of those type of things. So when he made it, it was like, yo, we gotta rep. You know what I mean?
Right, right.
It was one of those type of things. And then everybody was really, really doing well. Like Wu-Tang came out, and Black Moon, and then you had Nas. You had a nice movement that was coming in at that time.
Yeah.
And this was the Brooklyn Chamber. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. This is the Brooklyn movement. And everybody just got behind it. It was what it was.
What do you call it? And then so, me and Mo were talking about, by the second album of Life After Death, right, for Biggie,
right,
when he was like, this is after Junior Mafia, this is after One More Chance remixes, this is like after he's kind of like a bona fide star,
right,
and then Little Kim and all of this stuff. At this time, MoMA has this theory, when like kind of Mace was in the back burner, that Mace was ghostwriting some of Biggie's lyrics on, like, let's say, More Money, More Problems.
My theory was based on the fact that when Biggie had a new flow,
right
around the time that Mace came in, on the same songs as Mace, I'm meaning the 112 remix, More Money, More Problems, and potentially some of the verses from Hypnotize, I was like, the flow just sounds so similar to Mace.
All right, I can explain that. Now, me being around and being really cool with the staff and actually just being there with all that stuff, it was a 2-year period where Biggie wrote 4 albums.
Yeah.
He wrote the Junior Mafia, he wrote the Little Kim, he wrote the Ready to Die, and he wrote the Life After Death. But he was also writing the Puff album.
Mm-hmm.
So that was in between his album and the Life After Death. So it was more or less in between that time of 96. It was, the album was actually not called No Way Out. The album was actually called Goodfellas Hell Up in Harlem.
Yeah.
So it was an introduction to these guys, Maces and the Black Robs and the Loxes and stuff of that nature. Mm-hmm. So a lot of those guys were taking their cues from Biggie more so than anything. Mm-hmm. So when they went away, those records were priority for Big. Like the versions that you would hear would be, oh yeah, Big rhymed off of that. He may use it, he might not use it. And if he, you know, if you put something on it and he liked it, he'll keep his stuff on the record. You know what I mean? Because what you're saying about Mace, yeah, his flow, Mace was actually quoted from Big to be, yo, he's my favorite rapper right now.
Mm-hmm.
Because he made pop records, like, or he made girl records sound easy because he was very simple with it. And Big's flow at that time, it wasn't so much his flow, it was more or less what he was trying to say into his cadence.
Mm-hmm.
So he was more or less, yo, Nas, everybody's giving props for Nas because he's rhymes. So he wanted to prove a point more so with his rhymes, because he had just came out of that whole, I'm grimy. He was doing an Onyx style. He was doing, you know, his voice was up. Then when his voice changed, then he gained weight. It took different forms. Not saying that he wasn't influenced, but I'm saying ghostwritten, no way. No way.
And then,
no way.
Mo, your argument is that to make an album like Life After Death, a double album, right?
That was my argument, that at that point you're so busy, you're doing award shows, you're traveling around the world,
it takes
you're shooting music videos,
it takes
you put out a double album, and then you see it in today's culture of hip-hop that a lot of people look at it as a collaborative effort. And to me, somebody like Puff, who's really pragmatic, I don't put it past Puff to just have writers collaborate on his number one artist project.
I was in a lot of those sessions as far as when they were doing a lot of stuff. Uh-huh. But Big was actually away from the game for about a year and a half. Like, even when Little Kim was out, he wasn't doing any like appearances with Kim on the road. He was letting them stand alone.
He was in that car crash.
He was in the car crash, right. Also. He was laid up as well. Yeah. And then another thing was too, contractually, he knew that at some point he was going to be out of his deal, or he was going to be able to move on and be able to make his own company. You know, mm-hmm, what I mean? So it was a lot of different stuff that he was doing. He was actually, how you say, stack the deck. He was kind of like building currency to make
his next move.
Right. So it was a lot of stacking. A lot of, yo, give me this, give me this, give me this, give me this, give me this. Because he had beats from everybody. I mean, like, he even had Dilla beats. A lot of people don't know that he was rhyming over Dilla. That's crazy. He was getting beats from everybody because he was the top dog.
Yeah.
He was the top 100%. Dog. So him making records and him doing stuff was nothing. It was just that he didn't get a chance to record a lot of the stuff because it was like he was in his head.
Yeah.
Or, you know what I mean? You know, that type of stuff.
See, what I pictured was like during that Bad Boy era, right? It was Daddy Studios, right? Everyone's Daddy Studios. I'm thinking, I've never been there. There's multiple studios everywhere. There's one guy who's like working on, like, there's one guy producing one song, another guy producing one song. The Lox is one room. Little Kim's in one room. You know, Biggie's in one room. Junior Mafia's in one room. Everyone's kind of coming in and be like, yo, that's dope. That beat's dope. Let me write a verse. And everyone's just kind of writing a verse and everything. And everything's just kind of like getting mixed up and mixed around. And then they're like, all right, it's time to make Biggie's album. We want to do a double album. And then Biggie's just hearing these beats and maybe hear More Money, More Problems. And he hears maybe it's a Mace song. You know what I'm saying? And then Diddy take, and then Biggie ends up like, yo, I want a verse on that. Mm. And then maybe Mace's last verse, or there's a verse with Mace that where Biggie just kind of takes some of the words, or I don't know if he, like, he would have rhymed Mace's joint word for word, but you know what I mean, where he was just like, I'll take that song and I'll take this song.
But at that time, and just not to deflect or whatever, but at that time when people would write records, they would kind of write it in a we made it together type of situation.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Even if you had laid your verse, they would try to do something to where it was similar so it made sense.
But
like even with the Brooklyn's Finest, they're using the same flow over that beat, Jay-Z and what's name, but they're doing different things.
Yeah.
So it wasn't like, yo, Jay wrote for Big. It was just that they used the same pattern.
Right.
You know what I mean? You know, and then a lot of people don't know that with the Puff joints, a lot of times it wouldn't even be Big rhyming Puff's joints, or it wouldn't be Mace rhyming. It would be a Jadakiss one time. It would be a Styles one time.
Mm-hmm.
So he'll get it from different places. And historically, Big didn't like to stay in the studio because Puff would nag him. So whenever Big would go to the studio, it would be, I got this joint and I'm laying it today. And then I'm breaking out.
Mm-hmm.
You feel what I'm saying?
Yeah, yeah.
So that type of Kanye type of feeling that you're saying,
yeah,
really wouldn't happen. What happened more so with the R&B type of records. More so than anything. And if you look at it on Life After Death, they went to Jamaica on some relaxation shit.
Yeah, yeah.
And Big wasn't able to get around like that. To be mobile.
Mm-hmm.
But they went there to, you know, to record the album and stuff like that. All those songs were already pretty much done.
Man, to have been a fly on that wall, yo.
Yeah, I know.
Also, can I add one thing to this?
Yeah, yeah.
So I actually went to school with Mace. And I remember when he left school because he got signed to Bad Boy. It was like, we had a lot of the same friends. I didn't really know him more than just saying what's up. But everyone was talking about it. Like, yo, Mace got signed to Bad Boy. He's leaving. And he was really tight with one of my apartment mates, Chris. And he told me that he was like, yeah, he's riding for Puffy. Like, he's, you know, which is not a surprise to anyone, right?
Yeah.
But I feel like he would have known, or he would have confided in him or told him if he was writing for Big, too. You know what I mean? That would have been kind of a major thing to brag about, right?
And Mace totally changed up his style from when he came out, from when he was with Children of the Corn, from when he was with Big L, from when even when he was with the Locks. Even when he was with the Locks. And the Locks, that record was 98. Niggas Done Started Something came out in 98 with DMX. And it sounds nothing like the 1-2 that he was doing with More Money, More Problems. Right, it was like, you know what I mean? So,
well, if you look at the way hip hop changed from when Big came out with his first record, it was on the Who's the Man soundtrack, so that's 92. And then by the time Illmatic came out in 94, the way people made records between that time till just 2 years later was drastically different.
Yeah, because
the tempo slowed down.
But the stakes got raised also.
Yeah, and people stopped shouting. Yeah, you know, they started, like, Nas changed everything. He changed everything. And
I wouldn't really say that.
No, really?
I wouldn't really say that because Tribe Called Quest was a lot bigger at that point.
But I never really, like, I always put Jungle Brothers and De La and Tribe kind of, like, in this own universe of, like, they're, like, hip-hop is here and they're just kind of, like, on the outside.
Yeah, but
you're right. But Tribe kind of entered that.
The thing is, it was like, if you're looking at it from when it came out, you got the Low Iron Theory,
right?
That's 91. That's the big album. That's the pace that's setter. Then you got 92. You got the Chronic. That's the pace setter.
Right.
Then you come out in 93. You got Doggy Style, Midnight Marauders. Those are the pace setters. Then you got 94. You got Illmatic. That's a whole different type of pace.
Right.
It's a whole different energy, direction, everything. So from year to year, it's like, those, you know, they call it the golden era for a reason, you know what I mean? Like, you know, it changed.
Also, 93, Wu-Tang came out,
of course.
But I remember when Ready to Die came out, I remember listening to it and being like, I could tell he made this record in 92.
His voice, his voice dropped.
Big Papa was clearly like a 94 record, right? Give me the loot was a 92 record,
Because he'd been sitting on these records for since he was signed,
like a year and a half or something like that,
right?
Even the references, what he was talking about, he was talking, you know, like, you know, it was like it was dated, So when he came out with Who Shot You, it was like, yo, I'm here. Yeah. So it was no reason for me to be doubted. Like,
I could do what I'm the dude.
You know what I mean?
When he came out with The What, I mean, I think I heard The What before the album came out.
Yeah.
But I was like, oh, okay. Like, this is, he just changed his whole.
Right.
Yeah. Because he sounded, his voice got deep. He was calm. Yeah.
What do you think? What do you think, Mo?
I'm dropping the charges, Your Honor. Charges dropped. Case dismissed.
Me and Never did not believe that shit 1 second.
I know, right?
It was about a fight moment.
It was so crazy though, like the way in that episode of the podcast when we were talking about it, we were so cocky and disrespectful though. Like when I look at the video of us talking about it, Mo's arrogance of like me asking like, so you thought Mace wrote for Biggie? And you're like, oh, without a doubt. And you were like, of course,
shit.
Of course, you know, and like in the video, and I thought that was so hilarious. And I'm sure, and you've been telling me that you and Goldfinger have been going back and forth. You've been taking it personally.
Yeah, I heat up his DMs crazy. I was like, yo, Mo, we gonna fight, yo. I'm gonna see hands. We gonna see hands, yo. I swear to God.
And it was that cockiness though, to just like, oh yeah, without a doubt, you know. He
it was good content, bro. It was good content.
Yeah, it was good.
Great content.
Got a lot of views.
a lot of Brooklyn motherfuckers was mad at you, though, right?
Yeah, that was mad.
What do you call it? It's so wait. As we enter, like the, I guess, I gotta talk about this because you have this coming up. It's like Tiki Disco.
Oh yeah,
10-year anniversary.
Uh-huh.
Right. Oh. You've been doing that for 10 years, and I
it wasn't up to me because Moma told me a long time ago, don't tell anyone how long a party's been going on because that dates you.
No anniversaries.
But there's three of us involved, and one of the guys just blasted it out before I had.
I was
about
to say because I saw your promoters, your 10-year anniversary.
Yeah. So now I just gotta roll with it. Once you put it out there, you know. Yeah.
And so I mean, so how did that party start?
The way that party started was
Did it have anything to do with what you were going through? Obviously, you know,
identity crisis wise.
Yeah, right? Kind of just after just like.
Nah,
you know.
I mean like, you know, no, I didn't have any. It was just I can. So with our first summer was 2010. By 2010, I was already kind of, I think, fairly done with doing like the club grind that I was on. No, that's not really true. I don't know. I don't really remember. But it was a little bit of a transitional period. So I think I was doing this party at Submercer that was kind of popular, and it was, you know, a house music and disco night, and playing
with Lloydski,
with Lloyd.
Shout out to Lloyd,
and other stuff like that. Like trying to, you know, just change my direction and trying to make a name for myself in a different way. So and one of the big things I was doing was I had a blog.
So stereotypical. By the way, I love that blog.
Thank you. The blog thing kind of was like a big deal for me because I felt like I could finally, talk about the music I really cared about, and like it was so easy to use. Mm-hmm. So I was talking about everything that I really liked from like being a kid, like music, comic books, old clubs, like just that whole kind of thing.
And you also used to post like 12 inches, personal 12 inches.
Yeah, I would rip my 12. Yeah, I don't know.
It was just the name of the blog was Outside
Broadcast.
And what did that, where did that come from?
There's a Clash song called This Is Radio Clash, and the dub is called Outside Broadcast. So I kind of like a little bit got my name out there from that blog, like, because it was like all of a sudden, like, wow, I can just reach people all over the world. I came to the internet kind of late, side note. So at first I kind of like used to make fun of my cousin because he would be in chat rooms and all this. I'd be like, let's go outside, you know? But anyway, so then in 2010, this guy Andy Pry writes me and Lloyd a message. And I guess me and Lloyd had kind of made a name for ourselves locally with that party at Submercer. Mm-hmm. And he sent us a message and was like, I bartend at this place called Roberta's in Bushwick. You guys want to come play records one day outside? Mm-hmm. And I was like, I'm not going to Bushwick. Like, I didn't know it was starting to gentrify. I was just like, I don't even think I had ever been there before, you know? And I thought he was out of his mind.
And just letting all our non-New Yorkers know, Bushwick is
used
like
to be crazy.
I mean, Brooklyn in itself, Red Hook, Bushwick, it was fucked up neighborhoods. I mean, like, if you didn't know anybody there, and
you didn't want to be there if you didn't know anybody.
Yeah. Right. You had to feel comfortable in a bad neighborhood to go there. Like, you wouldn't just go to a bad neighborhood.
I mean, growing up in high school, hearing about Bushwick and Red Hook was just scary. Like, the shit we were hearing about, you know? And then plus being in Manhattan, like, it was just like, you know, Manhattan, it was cool to go uptown. It was cool to go to the Bronx, but like, it was like another.
For some reason, going deep down in Brooklyn, it was like a whole different story.
Well, it's like East New York. East New York was like another world kind of thing. It's like, because like Brooklyn motherfuckers would kind of fuck with Queens motherfuckers, and Manhattan would fuck with Bronx, and it would be kind of, for us, it was different. Like when you go to Brooklyn, it was like, and then, you know, we would listen to like Mobb Deep. Like, you know, like, listen, we would listen to like
Jay-Z, Marcy Projects.
We would listen to interludes and be like, you know, we met a shorty from Brooklyn, like, we could get set up. Like, we like try to go to her building or something.
I mean, all true, by the way.
It's true. When I was growing up, my uncle lived in Flatbush, and we would go once a year for Easter. And I remember it just felt like I was driving to like another country, you know, like it was so far removed from where I was. Anyway, So I texted Lloyd. I was like, you want to go to Bushwick? And he was like, yo, I think it'll be fun. Let's just give it a try. Mm-hmm. And we went, and it was like, I was actually going through footage of that first summer for to put up on Instagram. And I think even our busiest night might have been like 100 people max. Mm-hmm. But it was like just something about playing records outside. I didn't really happen. I believe I hadn't had any experience doing that, you know.
Maybe the do-over. Had you played the do-over?
No, not yet. Oh yeah, I had played it once.
Yeah,
right, in 2009, I think. So and they used to have roller skating in Central Park where they would have a DJ play, and I used to go there a lot. And but overall I didn't feel like that was like a and what's it called, Soul Summit,
right.
But I didn't feel like I didn't have any experience playing records outside. It just felt amazing. And like when the sun would go down and the crowd that came was, you know, a lot like some friends, but this whole other scene that I didn't really have experience playing for, and they were really open-minded and just kind of down to dance to anything. Yeah. And I me and Lloyd looked at each other like, yo,
this is it,
we got to do this every other week all summer.
Quick anecdote, I DJ'd the second ever,
because the original idea was that Andy Pry was going to have different guests all summer, and me and Lloyd are like, no, we're gonna be the guys.
And then you guys basically just
we had to travel.
You and Lloyd were away.
No, he just booked you. He didn't. Me and it wasn't because we were away. He wanted to originally have it be him with different DJs, I think.
Wow.
Yeah, you were just booked. It wasn't because we were away.
Took food out my mouth, yo.
Okay. And now his party has like five times as many people.
But he built a legacy. So you know, you gotta give him.
Nah, but bro, it was meant. It happened the way it was supposed to happen.
For sure, yeah.
That party was definitely made for Andy, Lloyd, and Ellie. They're just like. It was a perfect match.
Yeah, so the first summer was cool, and like we were really excited. The second summer, we announced the first one. And it wasn't, I don't know how we announced it because it wasn't Facebook invite yet. But
there was Facebook.
There was Facebook, but not that thing where you post a party and then you invite. It was just, and we got there, and pretty soon there was like a line, like a 2-hour line to get in. And
it was free.
It was free. Mm-hmm. And by the end of the night, so the first Tiki Disco of the second season is in my top 5 parties I've ever DJed. Like, I still can remember every moment so vividly. Like, you know how you have those nights where, like, I still remember the first time I heard Danny Crivet DJ. I remember the first time I heard you DJ. Mm-hmm. Like, and you can remember songs and, like, moments. Like, then they played that into this, into that. Like, I have memories of that night that are just, like, I feel like I've been chasing those ever since. Man. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. Like, trying to get it back. And, that was when I realized, like, this is a special thing happening, you know? And it was cool to also, like I said before, like, I didn't recognize, like, 50, 60, 70% of the crowd, mm-hmm. which was a nice thing. Like, okay, like, I'm getting older, but, like, maybe I'm going to still be able to keep doing this. Because I used to think, like, well, DJing's going to be a rap when I'm 35, mm-hmm. you know? Like,
yeah.
Now we're at 10 years. We've switched venues like 3 times to accommodate the growing numbers of people. We didn't want people to wait outside for 3 hours to get into our
And room, you guys currently have it at the Well.
We have it at the Well, which is in Bushwick, and it's big, and it's intimidating actually to every year. I'm like, how are we going to fill this place? But we do.
And it's still doing all vinyl?
We play a lot of vinyl, but it's not like a rule. We have the CD players too.
Oh, okay.
Because there's so much new music I like to play and edits that I make. Yeah. But I do like to bring records out when I can.
Yeah.
For no particular reason. I'm not a purist at all. No. But I just like it. It's fun. It's crazy, man. It's been amazing. So.
And you guys do it every...
Other Sunday.
Every other Sunday.
Yeah. Yep.
The crazy thing about it is that their parties are like, these are like the remedies for New York nightlife. If you're talking about like you really want to have like a really good function, these are the type of events, more DJ based, more DJ curated.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Controlled and shit like that. That's the remedy for it being like, yo, what's wrong with New York? Nah. The way to do it is to have the DJ be involved with the party and then create the night.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Because if I'm keeping it real, the dance party, the everyday people party, his party, fucking spinners parties when he does like Wonderful, he does the Prince versus Michael Jackson. Mm-hmm. You have a lot of, you know, DJ curated events that are like the originals, the originals party.
Right.
It's like those are the best parties in New York at this present time.
Yeah. I mean, things really shifted because, like, it used to be like you'd have a Derek Corley or a Bill Spector or they were the promoters.
Right.
They might have some sub promoters, right? And then they hire a DJ. And then at some point it became like, can this DJ bring a crowd?
Not even that. Right? It became 15, 20 promoters now.
Now
you have 15, 20 promoters and you have 15, 20, 35 different directions.
And then they would book like five DJs a night. Yeah,
and then everybody is, you know, looking to get their little you know, from the event. And then now it's not even about the party. It's about my look and my little drink tickets and, you know, bottle at the end of the night.
Right.
And then now it's a shit show.
So a lot of the good parties, I think, that started going on recently were like DJs kind of taking matters into their own hands, I guess.
Totally.
And then it's also the day party aspect too.
Yeah, that's definitely. And then since we started that, I mean, day parties are everywhere now. And since since he started
Everyday People,
I mean, now the clubs, like, it's almost like if a new club opens in Brooklyn, they have to have a roof,
right?
So they can do day parties in the summer.
It's now, like, the day parties were out like when they were doing like the Meatpacking District, but they were kind of douchey. They were
Bagatelle.
They were champagne brunches, but they were douchey.
Yeah.
When was this? Different.
This is like literally right before we started Everyday People, like 2010, 2011.
So
it was popping off in the Meatpacking.
It was kind of like a Lavo brunch, like EDM.
Mimosas.
EDM exactly. thing, people but, dancing but those on the places tables.
Were unlike, you know, Lavo's a full-fledged nightclub, those places were just restaurants.
Restaurants.
Right.
So you have, like, sunlight coming in. It felt like daytime.
It felt exactly like daytime. Like, you walk out, you're wasted, and it's 6 o'clock. You're like, oh, shit. Like, it's 6 o'clock. You know what I mean? Like, I've been here since, you know.
Yeah.
But it was full-on brunch mode. But it was very bridge and tunnel, but very douchey, though. It's like, you know what I mean? Yeah. Even if you wanted to, like, just the, yo, let's see what's going on. It was just... had that real slime to it, you know what I mean?
Slime. I have a question, Goldie. Are you noticing that? Are you spending more day parties, or do you spend any day parties? Or
that's not really my thing.
Not at all. And then another thing is, why do you think people are gravitating to day parties?
Because the economics of it. Also because people have responsibilities and shit. You get older.
Yeah.
You have kids. You know, sometimes you don't. You know, the recovery time of you getting fucking wasted at late at night. Mm-hmm. You know, you waste 2 days. Like, you know, you can go out in the day, afternoon, have, you know, still see some sunlight. Okay, cool. You know, I can take the train and I don't have to drive.
Right.
So it's a lot of different
and
factors.
Honestly, it's just also like... availability, like when you're a minority, it's hard to get these slots on Friday night at the club, on Saturday night at the club. They usually relegate us to Sunday night.
Let's talk about that though.
Hey, I'm glad you brought that up because I've been hesitant about bringing the race thing up as far as with DJing.
It has a lot to do with race.
But it has a lot to do with race and even positioning, like as far as with where DJs are at, you know, in certain points of their career and stuff like that. Like, yo, I feel different when I'm playing a record and I could be playing like a pop record, whatever like that. Like I'll get looks from people in the crowd. They'll be looking at me like, what the fuck is he doing?
Mm-hmm.
But I'm playing a hit record. I'm playing a actually good record. You know what I mean? It's probably pop now, but I would have been playing this record 4 months ago.
Uh-huh.
You just happen to hear me play it now.
Right.
But then it's like, if I play something like older or retro, I still get those same looks. Like if I got three fucking heads or something. Like, you know, what the fuck is going on?
From the crowd, you mean?
Yeah, like it'll be people. Like, you know, like in the adverse. No offense, but I've seen like white DJs play the hardest of the hardcore hip hop and get no looks at all.
Right.
Like MOP type Gangstar album cuts. Like they're not playing this to dance to. No, he's getting away with playing this. Like you can actually play this.
Yeah.
But it has a different connotation. If I was to play that same record, it would be, you know, oh shit, what's going on? You know what I mean?
Can you give me an example of some of the songs that you would play that would be considered like pop?
Yeah,
and you
get
a look?
I did a party 2 years ago.
Yeah.
And I played the Bee Gees.
Yeah.
Which is like bangers.
I love the Bee Gees.
Bangers.
And that shit rang off, but when they looked in the booth, like they was about to give me the hands up, like, and they looked in the booth, like, oh shit, like this guy explained the Bee Gees, like,
yeah,
what the fuck is going on? In you. yeah. So it's, you know, it's like just to go back on a point, DJ M, when he was out, he used to come DJ a lot of times at my parties, so he would go to like Etoile or fucking Cheeto or even Envy, you know, and these primarily mostly like mixed black. On Spanish, Puerto Rican, you know, parties.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So predominantly that. And he will be like, yo, how do you think I'm going to do here? I'm like, yo, just play hip-hop. You dope. Play hip-hop.
Right.
And he would go in and he would do his set. And it would just be like, yo, he knows about Rock the Mic.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, like, what the fuck do you think? You know, he's playing hip-hop. Mm-hmm. You know? But he would get, I think, not a pass, but they wouldn't scrutinize him as much.
Right.
If it had me being me playing fucking, you know,
Pussycat,
you know,
Dolls.
Yeah.
Which is a banger.
For a white crowd.
For a black crowd too.
Oh, for a black crowd.
Black
too.
Crowd or a white crowd. Like it would you know, you get
it would be judgment.
It would be judgment with it. Yeah. You know what I mean? I'm curious to see how it's gonna be because now that Afrobeats is taking over, like it's really having a real presence. How is that gonna translate to when other DJs have to play that music?
White DJs start playing that.
You know what I mean?
Beats,
like, and it's good music.
But
it's good
happening.
Music.
It's happening.
It is happening. Yeah. But I'm just saying, are they going to have that? Because when I play Afrobeats, I do get from the crowds, they can take Latin.
Mm-hmm.
But if I play Afrobeats, I would probably have to sweeten it with something very, very, very commercial as far as reggae. Just to kind of soften the palate.
Right.
You know
why,
what I mean?
Well, why is that? Explain that. What is the judgment?
Well, just so for me not to lose the crowd, it's like you kind of, you know, when you're introducing new stuff, it's kind of like the sandwich theory. You have to give them this,
right,
and then put something that's familiar, and then kind of sandwich, you know.
Yeah, layer it. Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, kind of like, you know, make sure that you're covered on both ends.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? So if you're going to give them something weird, at least have it, you know, where, you know, you have some type of backup.
Right.
So when I like play Afrobeat, and it's not to the crowds that I'm doing now, maybe it's not as familiar as it would be as Moma's crowd or Eli's crowd, you know, mm-hmm, with their parties. But if I'm playing it, you kind of got to kind of sugar them into it.
Right.
So let me play Sean Paul. So I'll play that because everybody's like that. Right? Okay.
Right.
And then I can play that. And then maybe I can come back with something, something like that, you know, right, that they kind of know,
right,
just to get that record off.
I got what you're saying.
Until they get trained to hear it or they have it on their own time, they'd be like, oh, that's the record that they play at the other club that I went to. Oh, I guess it's popular because more people are playing it.
So, like, I'll be in Vegas and I'll see, you know, I'll have a hip hop crowd or a mixed crowd or whatever I have there. And then if I just start playing Afrobeats, I'll immediately see a response from people who know it or who may be African or Nigerian or whatever, and they'll go off and they get super excited, I guess, from hearing it in Vegas and then looking and seeing an Asian DJ come up. They'll come up and they'll give me a pound. They'll be like, oh, this is dope and everything like that. But I'm just wondering, is there a judgment if it becomes widespread, if Afrobeat becomes like, you know, at a point when reggaeton was kind of like huge, it was like Gasolina, Oye Mi Canto, that whole time, and then the way mainstream treated reggaeton, like they were just like, all right, y'all ain't got no more hits, like y'all kind of done, like this genre's dead. And then there was like a dead season.
I mean, people did that with Baltimore club music too.
Yeah,
right.
And they kind of appropriated it. Well, they were like, yeah, let's take it.
I feel it's a little different because you had a gateway drug to reggaeton, which was dancehall. Right.
Right.
Back
right.
then, DJs were playing hip hop and dancehall, right, so you could introduce reggaeton.
Right.
I think DJs from like a commercial world trying to play Afro beats right now.
Yeah,
that's like really deliberate. That's right, like really intentional. Right. Like, uh-huh, how are you gonna introduce this?
Right.
You're not playing any dance hall.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You're playing mostly like hip hop in right. the club. This is, you're just trying to get some stamp of approval, or you're just trying to keep up with the times. And that's why it's such a struggle to watch all these people try to introduce Afrobeat in their party in a way that's not organic. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm. And the crowd is like reading them for that, kind of? Is that what's happening?
It depends on the crowd, though.
No, right? I think just, you know, a lot of DJs are trying to either keep up with the times, or right, they genuinely love Afrobeats.
But they can't figure out
But they didn't do anything up to that point in their career to be able to introduce that right. to their mm-hmm. crowd.
Right, right, right.
You know what I mean? It's like, yeah, it's all cool. Like, something got to give. You're going to take all the big club checks, and you're going to take all this casino money.
Right.
And now you want to play cool music. Good luck to you. You're right. That's not how it right. works.
That's not how it
you
works.
Actually have yeah. to pave that way
right.
so that when the new music Bingo. Comes, you're able to drop it at the party.
So me playing Afrobeat in a mainstream
Well,
Vegas
you actually
room.
Play quite a bit of reggaeton.
Yes.
And
I love reggaeton.
And you still play dancehall.
Yes.
You're one of the few guys that tries to do all of that.
Right.
In
yeah.
Vegas.
I mean, yeah.
Until they
I'm
pull
sure
you.
I'm sure some of the managers hate when I do it, but right. I just do it anyway. Right. Never would be the same one of yeah. those guys. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah.
But we also have like really deep New York roots in the clubs where we would have to know reggae sets, we would have to know everything,
exactly,
and we'd
yeah,
have to play everything. And
but it's not only that, though. It's like, I think race is playing a little bit more into a lot of the music, because, like, for me to play, like, just say if I wanted to play Old Town Road right now.
Right.
And if I play it, and it's, like, kind of mixed crowd or whatever like that.
Yeah.
I kind of get that look like, is he serious or is he joking?
Do you get that from black people?
I get that from all people.
Right. What
so
is
they're
Old
trying
Town
to
Road?
Figure it out. They're trying to figure out. All right, like,
so we got to help Ellie out.
First off, first Old Town Road is
a black record.
It's
a black country
trap
country
trap record. It's like the biggest record.
Country trap.
Well, it's a young black artist.
Uh-huh.
His name Little Nas X.
Oh, I heard of him.
And right. on the remix, who do you get on the remix?
Billy Ray Cyrus.
He got Billy Ray Cyrus on the remix.
Just because he had to get Billy Ray Cyrus because they were
just to justify the country.
Yeah.
Oh, because it already sounded country. as it was.
No, just, right. But they wouldn't allow it to be country because they said it had too many elements of hip hop and other stuff.
So I actually want to play it. I actually want to play it just to see if Ellie fucks with it.
It actually samples Nine Inch Nails, Ellie. So.
Yeah. Yeah.
In a while, like.
I only know one Nine Inch Nails song. Closer. Is it Closer?
No, nah, it's not Closer.
Okay.
It's
I don't know anything.
Like a B side cut.
Nah, it's not Closer.
Nah, but yeah, that's what it
I like this. This is history.
Yeah, I'm gonna take my horse to the old town road. I'm gonna ride till I can't no more. I'm gonna take my horse to the old town road. I'm gonna ride till I can't no more.
I got the horses in the back. Horse stock is attached. Head is matted black. Got the bushes black to match.
And so this, this artist, a fairly young kid, right?
Right, 19 years old.
He wanted it to chart in the country, and they wouldn't let him chart in country. And then Billy Ray Cyrus got on the record, Word. And it started charting on the country.
All right, now, in that instance right there, now that record gets played. Now, I'll get looks from the black crowd, the white crowd, and they're all trying to figure out. First off, he's got balls. He's playing his record, right?
Mm-hmm.
But then they're trying to figure out, is this a joke or does he really want me to react to this record?
Right.
So now you got the people that are looking at it like, if I react too much, am I a white guy? If I react too much, if I'm black, am I trying to, you know what I mean?
It's like, is this record it's like big in hip hop clubs?
It was number one song in the country.
It was number one song for like 5 weeks.
Yeah, yeah.
Like five
Billboard
weeks.
Number one, yeah.
Ellie, I put it this way. It beat... it beat God's Plan Drake in streaming first week streams.
Right.
So now it's like it's like a conversation. Sometimes I play records just so I can get people to talk while they're at the party.
Right.
Like just records just so when you go to the bar, they're bringing up something. Like, you know, it could be current events or just something. You know, I'm just trying to get you to interact.
Right.
So if I play this record and I get a reaction, because one reaction is better than no reaction.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
So I get you to react, what's really going on? And we're having a bigger conversation about this one record.
Well, let's categorize it in a club setting, okay? Like in a different club setting. If we're DJing in a mainstream mixed crowd club, are we playing this record? I definitely am.
Yes.
Right. Yeah. If I'm in Vegas or if I'm in New York Marquee, right, I'm playing this record.
Mm-hmm.
Now, if I'm doing... a predominantly hip-hop, quote-unquote, hood party. Am I playing this record?
No.
I probably won't.
No.
You might.
Yeah.
See, well, that depends on how I sell it and how I play it.
Right, that's what I'm saying. So exactly, it's all about the sell. It's all about the sell on right. that. But now, if I'm playing it for a predominantly white crowd.
Yes.
What is that saying about the record, and what is that saying about me playing the record?
So
and that's a whole different conversation.
So exactly
it's
what
like,
you,
am I tap dancing right now?
There you
Bingo.
Go.
I might tap dance.
And this is crazy because in this time right now,
yeah.
it's like it's not like it hasn't happened before, but race is playing a way in how you're DJing and how you're being perceived as DJing.
So exactly the way you said that, me DJing a hip hop quote unquote hood crowd, being Asian, there's already a judgment on me. So if I play
and
little,
have you always felt that way?
Of course.
Really?
Yeah. I have to prove myself.
Right.
Right. As soon as they see me, they're like, "What's going on here?" And then as soon as if I play Little Nas X, it kind of further validates further validates that he shouldn't be here. Right, he's playing this shit.
But
right
you might
now,
get
you know
away.
I mean?
With, you might be able to get away with it.
But it would still
so
come off as ignorance.
But no,
on my
you
part.
Might be able to get away with it.
Yeah.
Whereas me, I might get disclaimed for it. You know what I mean?
Right. Mm-hmm.
But the thing is, the crazy thing about it is, and here's another part.
Well, the thing is, I will get disclaimed as well. I might get disclaimed, but they were like, he don't know no better. That's
but the, why he's playing but the crazy thing about it is that the technology has a lot to play with it as well.
Mm-hmm.
Because now with the technology, everybody feels like they can be a DJ. Now, if I was Larry Levan and Old Town Road came out in 84 and he played it, Larry Levan's a god. Because he's got heart to play this record that may be cross-generational, cross-genre, this, that, and the third.
Right.
But he's going to play this record. And you know what? Why the fuck did Larry play this record?
But a lot of
but being that so many people have computers and they're so-called DJs now, it's like you're going to get that DJ because it's going to be like, yo, My man could be a DJ. He could have played that record, or he could have not played that record. It's the individuality, the specialness of the being an individual, mm-hmm. playing a record that's a little left of center, right. is a little bit less now. You dig what I'm saying?
I definitely dig with you. I mean, Nas. Mm-hmm. Never.
Yeah. Little Never X.
Little Never X. We've always talked about this, where, like, you playing rock, like, remember in the early 2000s, you doing, like, clubs.
Yeah.
And you being, like, a black DJ and playing rock.
Yeah.
And stuff. And then, like, the judgment of, like, if you play too much hardcore hip-hop, and you're DJing for like a bougie white crowd, mm-hmm. there's the judgment that, yo, he's a black DJ playing hood shit.
Yeah.
And then if he's playing like rock, it's like another thing. It's like, oh my God, like I didn't know.
I kind of get a pass.
Yeah.
It's like, oh yeah, he's playing enough rock. It's all good.
Yeah, yeah.
But yeah.
Mm-hmm. But there's that there's always that judgment. It's kind of like the thing where like sometimes like women DJs can play some of the hardest core hip hop. And it kind of, it's just like, yo, she's down. She can.
Or the most misogynistic type shit. I've been playing with I played with a female DJ, and I'm not going to say like a couple of years ago.
Yeah.
And she played fucking, her first record was Ain't No Fun If The Homies Can't Have None. Right. First record out the gate. First record from the top. Come on, man.
I mean, when you hear actually like...
Wait, before I interrupt, are we okay to say female DJ on the podcast? Because Moma is the advocate of woman DJ.
I mean, I try not to use the term female DJ. Some women don't mind it.
Yes.
Some do.
Yes.
So I just try to say she, like, you know.
Okay, she.
I DJ'd with this young lady and she played blah, blah,
okay.
blah.
Okay. That's fair.
We have this conversation all the time.
That's fair.
But yeah, what were you saying, Ellie? Sorry to interrupt.
I was just going to say, I feel like everybody should kind of feel a little bit weird when they play Ain't No Fun If The Homies Can't Have None. I mean, like, it's like one of those records, like, at the time, I kind of just was like, it's another one of these records. But right. when you listen to it now, you're like, I can't believe.
Yeah, it's a couple of cringeworthy records. It's a couple of cringeworthy records that you
like. It was okay to just make a song literally about gang raping.
Yeah, it's very rapey.
Hey, yo, and to tell you the truth, it's like now as I get older, I'm playing a lot more clean versions of records. Mm. It just feels better.
Mm-hmm. Can I tell you, when I play Noriega Nothing, I take out the nigga part.
Oh yeah, I used
what
to.
What you want for the nigga? Right. For some reason, I take it out. I don't let that part ride
you don't
anymore.
Have the clean version?
I know. I play the dirty version.
Well, that's because you put it to so many white people.
I was about to say it's weird when that record was always really popular with white people.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And so it was weird when they would sing that chorus so confidently, right?
Yeah. So when I do play the dirty version, but when that part comes up, I always like start from the beginning. Oh. Instead of saying nigga, go, what you want to do? Oh. What you trying to do? Oh.
I got the clean version too.
So I came up, you know, DJing in New York to like really mixed crowds, you know, black, white, Hispanic, Asian, other. And so the settings were pretty intimate. So you'd cut out the music and people would say nigga. And it was like, it was all right.
Mm-hmm.
And then once I opened for you at Light on a Monday night in Vegas, this is maybe like 8 years ago, right?
Oh, okay.
You sure Light or Jet?
No, Jet. It was Jet.
It could have been Jet.
It was Jet. And I'm doing my opening set, trying to set Crooked up nice, and I'm playing Biggie. And he goes, and if you don't know, now you know. And muscle memory. I just cut out the music. And I just looked at 800 white people go, nigga! And I was just shook. Like, I almost forgot to bring the music back up. I was like, I gotta think twice about when I'm doing this.
That was the one record, right? Uh-huh. That you would kind of like, you were always iffy about, or like it would bother you sometimes.
A little bit, yeah.
Yeah, that one is just
that one is like a landmine.
PTSD.
Yeah. And then,
PTSD,
then it says yo. Then it says the World Trade blow up, like the World Trade. You're like, yeah. Oh god, yeah. It's like, oh, god. You're like, this shit is a landmine, yeah, yo. Yeah. That's like this record is a landmine right now.
Yeah, it's a weird. I mean. It's, I don't know.
Can we go back to like the about the white DJ playing hip hop?
Yeah.
And that the black crowd was like, hey, he should be doing this?
Yeah.
Would this have happened 10 or 15 years ago before Trump got into office?
No, it has happened.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Not as much.
I don't think it's not really, man.
Totally has happened.
Nah.
Totally.
A white DJ playing hip hop and the black crowd was like.
Yeah, totally. I've seen it happen a lot.
Really?
A lot. A lot. I mean, I'm DJing with a lot of white.
I mean, I've DJed with Mark Ronson.
No, I've DJed with Ronson. Ronson can get her off. He's savvy, and you know he has a.
That's a perfect example. He got away with rocking to all black crowd.
Yeah, we know it was can, like he could do it. I saw you know Ronson, of course, do it. I saw what's the guy from
Scribble?
What's the guy from L.A.? He's like A Track, but he's not A Track. He's like AM, but he was out when AM was out. Big DJ. He used to be on the radio for a while.
Vice.
Oh, Vice.
My
is
boy
Mexican.
Vice.
Okay,
Vice is Mexican.
That's another one. Yeah. Right. Vice is Mexican.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. I didn't know that.
But I don't think his following knows that.
No. But no. Yeah, I don't think his following knows that.
He's Mexican, but can't speak Spanish.
They do. They do know his.
But you're talking about race, Mexican.
Yeah, I'm talking about as far as him coming to New York, him playing in front of a black crowd, and then you like him getting, you know, like him being able to DJ.
But nowadays, if that happened now, they wouldn't get that same reaction.
I'm not sure.
Well, here's what it always is, I feel, because I mean I've DJed for a lot of hip hop crowds, and I've remember when you linked me up with Big Stan,
yeah,
and I was doing Big Stan parties,
yeah,
oh and then God.
Shout out to Big Stan,
shout out to Big Stan,
where you at, Big Stan?
And I just knew, I had to know my shit, like I couldn't go up there and not know, like you know, how to play before I let go, and how to not play, you know. Shalimar or any of these. I had to know that shit. I had to know my reggae.
Mm-hmm.
And then even when I did like, you know, reggaeton parties in Washington Heights, I had that judgment. I always had judgment everywhere I went. It's not like I'm saying like, oh, I've been like, you know, it's unfair. I didn't think it was unfair, but I knew that I always had to prove myself.
Yeah.
And the thing is that you prove yourself by really going, seeing the crowd and seeing how deep. You know, and it's like when I break down a Las Vegas hip hop crowd now, there's like a down south hip hop crowd that is not open to certain hip hop, and they're not open to certain R&B or classics. Right. And then there's like a West Coast where like a Cutie Pie goes over a lot better than, you know what I'm saying? Like than a Before I Let Go.
But a lot of it is cultural too. It's cultural too. So you gotta kind of be tapped in to know that these records, like if you play the second verse of Before I Let Go, you better let it play all the way through.
Right.
You can't cut that record off. Or if you're in New York and you're playing hot music, you might want to let that record play out too. Right, you know what I mean? It's like and it's cultural. You have to kind of get those little cheat codes into finding out.
Yeah, and it's seeing how people react, whether, you know. You know, it's just black people are not all just one type of black people. Right. There's a wide range of black people.
Right. Exactly.
There's a wide range of Asian. There's Chinese, Korean, everything.
Yeah.
So it's like really knowing like, oh, those guys are from, you know, this is like a down south crowd. Oh, yo, they're from the West Coast. They're from the East Coast. Or they're from like Africa. Or they're from Europe. You know what I mean? Mm-hmm. And it's really just knowing all of that music and just learning as you go with the experience and being like, oh, they weren't really reacting to this. They're probably from the West Coast.
Yeah.
I'm going to do a little more zap. Mm-hmm. Like old school shit, or they're from the East Coast. Like I'm gonna do some soul for real. I'm gonna do like some, you know, some other shit like that.
Yeah. The best part about this whole era right now is the fact that there's so much fusion with the music. There's so many different styles that are going on that you kind of have to absorb and be around. Mm-hmm. Another thing is that in order for you to do this shit, you actually have to do the homework now. Mm-hmm. Just like what Mo was saying, like yo, if you're a big DJ and you're trying to get on the Afrobeat shit and be current. Yeah. You know what I mean? You have to actually do the research now. You actually have to know why Afrobeat is this person and techno is this person.
Right.
And that you actually have to study. You actually have to do it. So it's no time for frauding now, and you will be exposed.
Mm-hmm.
That's the best part about it, because everybody feels that because they have a computer that they are a DJ. Right. It's not the case, B. And those 20 records aren't going to get you off every single party. Not
facts.
Word.
Yeah. Steve, since we're on this subject, right, of kind of offending the crowd and whatnot or whatever, and the judgment of whatever, I know you kind of wanted to touch on this, and we wanted to speak on it, was the whole Michael Jackson, playing Michael Jackson. And I'm like, right now, I don't play any Michael Jackson unless if I'm in front of a predominantly white crowd, I will play the Jacksons, because they might not know some of the records are the Jacksons. Do you know what I mean?
Right.
Like Sunshine and like, you know, like Shake the Body. Yeah, living on. Yeah. So like I'll play that because they might not know like, oh, that's the Jacksons. That's Michael Jackson. And then, but I've
You mean, since his brothers are singing background vocals?
Yeah. Or just because it's not like the biggest pop record, like it's not known.
Right. It's not off of Thriller.
Jackson. Yeah, it's not like
or bad.
Yeah, right. Mm-hmm. But I mean, in Vegas, I've actually, you know, Jamie, you got in trouble for playing Jackson 5.
Yeah, I play I Want You Back, and I think the next day I got a text, we cannot play no Michael Jackson. I was like, fuck, he was 5, but yeah. And I'm like, and that's like the most classic.
Yo, was he really 5 when he did I Want You
He's
Back?
He's 5'6", I think.
Nah, he was like 10 or 11.
Oh, okay. He was 10. Same shit. Yeah. He was a kid. Damn, never fuck.
I'm sorry.
Get one thing wrong. Fuck, right.
But I'm defensive with Michael Jackson. You got to get your shit correct, man.
I was with you when the whole shit was happening.
True, yes.
But anyway, yeah, I got in trouble for playing I Want You Back, and I was like, dude, this is a timeless record. Everybody knows this record from, 7 years old up to whatever, 60. Everybody knows this record. And I got in trouble for it, and I was just like, oh, fuck. All right, I guess... It's really happening.
But it was
really,
like, it was during the week of exactly. when that documentary came out.
Yeah, but and then I played it like not thinking because it's like I said, it's a classic record that is timeless. That it like
way before he was a kid.
You don't think of it much, and then another thing, like I didn't believe much in the documentary. Exactly, didn't believe
but
shit.
But then one of the most greatest things happened, or not the greatest things, but I thought was the most boldest things that I've ever seen. In DJing, and I never seen it before like that, was I was at an Everyday People party, and a woman DJ played her first, she was getting on to start her set, and the first song she played was Michael Jackson. And it was right around the same week. It was still, the documentary was still fresh.
Right. It was the same week.
But it was almost like a social, it was like a political statement of being like, I don't believe that shit.
Right.
I'm playing this, and some people are like, obviously shocked, and some people are offended, but the way she played it, and she danced to it, and she was having a fun time.
Right.
It was almost like, it was a statement, and I've never seen that before in DJing in my life. And I got shivers, and I'm like, oh, she doesn't believe that shit. And her playing this further is just, it's saying like, yo, if you guys believe it, you guys are fools. I fucking don't believe it. And I'm going to play Michael Jackson.
All right, now tell me this. Now, how do you feel about how you would be viewed if you happen to play a record with R. Kelly in it now?
Oh, no, that's crazy.
That's different. I can't play it.
You're saying that she used it as a political statement, a statement. Do you feel like you would have to defend yourself for having to play that record? Just say you played a Jay-Z and Best of Both Worlds and one of those type of records. You know what I mean? Body. You play that with Jay-Z.
Where she's coming from and where I'm coming from is a different place, because where I'm coming from is a love of music,
right?
And it doesn't. And I've never really held the artist. I've never put the artist and the music together. Do you know what I mean? So for me, I can still enjoy Step in the Name of Love because I love the song. But I don't, I mean, I'm disgusted by R. Kelly.
But it's ill, though. It's like, can we pick and choose who we have that type of, synergy?
Right.
Because the reason why you love Stevie Wonder is because he's Stevie Wonder. So you love the music and the artist the same way. You love Prince. Because you love Prince, and it's almost like that synergy. You love the Beatles because you love the Beatles. You know what I mean?
But if something ever happened with Prince or Stevie Wonder, I would still love the music. It would be, it's so powerful to me, the music itself, that I would just be like, look, the music is insane. I can't deny the music.
Ellie, what were you going to say?
Well, I was just going to say that the difference between R. Kelly and Michael Jackson is that, okay, and I'm in full disclosure, I have not watched the Michael Jackson documentary.
Good for you.
Have no plans to watch
your time.
It.
Yeah, don't watch it. You need to watch it.
Yeah, you're good.
I don't exactly know why. I have some ideas about why I haven't watched it, but the R. Kelly thing though is not alleged.
Right.
Exactly. He's done these things. So I mean, at the end of the day, the Michael Jackson, I know I didn't see the documentary, but I don't care if people say, oh man, but if you watch it, you'll know it's true. It's still alleged,
right?
At the end of the day, it's still alleged. And the guy who made the movie will tell you that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. So that leaves a little bit of space for making your own decision.
Yeah.
You can make your own decision to play R. Kelly also, course. But you might also have the right to be judged for that.
Right.
In a way that a person who plays MJ maybe doesn't have the right to be judged.
Right.
Mm-hmm. You know, because you don't have to go along with what everybody thinks. Right. Just because a whole bunch of people went to Sundance and got traumatized because they heard gruesome details are going to traumatize you whether they happen or not.
Mm-hmm. Right.
It's a very unpleasant, and a lot of times people mistake
uncomfortability
with the truth.
With the truth.
And that is not always the case. So, you know, that's how I feel about
it. So, with that being said, are you playing Michael Jackson?
I mean, I think that, well, first of all, I want to be like, I always played Michael Jackson, but it hasn't been necessarily like, I think that the question is going to be more of a thing for me now that Tiki Disco is starting, because it's a good time disco R&B party where you want to play a good amount of songs that people can sing along to and stuff. I don't feel like on Wednesday nights we really ever play MJ anyway.
Mm-hmm.
And then when I'm playing like house and techno and stuff, mm-hmm. not really. I feel like I would think twice about it. It would be like if I queued up something, like I have an edit I made of Working Day and Night, because I got like the original stem, so I made like a remix.
Uh-huh.
I feel like I would like queue it up like on instinct, and then I might think about it. Might be like, oh.
That's happened to me. Like after the Michael Jackson situation, I was doing a party. Mm-hmm. I had a Michael Jackson record queued up.
Mm-hmm.
And before I dropped it, I thought about it. I'm like,
That's really unfortunate.
And so I just, right, I didn't play it. I know, exactly. Yeah.
I play it every fucking week. usually it's like, you know, my first five records, I'll play Michael Jackson just to say.
So
like,
you're making that statement. Yeah, I totally am.
So I don't play that shit. Are you playing R. Kelly?
No, I actually don't play R. Kelly because I love women.
No. I'm with you.
I don't.
And respect.
You know what I mean? Like, uh-huh. I'm not trying to fuck up my shit. With
okay, women. Yeah.
Like, you know what I mean? Like, I don't agree with that shit. And it's like, I know that all this stuff happened earlier and we were still playing R. Kelly's.
Right.
Whether we ignored it or whether we just looked past it, or it was like, oh, well, yeah. And, you know, we were being hypocrites about it.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know what I mean? It is what it is.
Yeah.
And then the outrage came.
Yeah.
It's very hard to, after the outrage comes, to be still significantly look the other way and be like, nah, it's the remix to Ignition. Nah, fuck that. You know what I mean? It's like, I think
we're all in the same boat here. Yeah. I don't think anyone plays R. Kelly.
No.
But some of us play Michael. I play MJ.
Right.
I don't play Baby Be Mine. That's weird, right? That's just the one that...
Because the name of the lyrics, song?
Yeah, it's so bizarre.
Yeah.
Baby Be Mine.
And that's one of the best Michael Jackson songs.
Yeah.
I don't think that
I'll still never forgive Chris Rock. No, did you ever see what Chris Rock said?
Yeah.
Yo, what was he
thinking? What did he say?
He was talking about...
How Baby Be Mine
is actually, going. Wasn't he talking about... He was saying something about somebody's album being perfect. And he's like, there's no Baby Be Mine on this album.
Kanye, he was talking about Kanye.
Yeah, suggesting
that Baby Be Mine is a throwaway record.
Yeah. When everyone knows crazy. The throwaway record is The Girl Is Mine.
Yeah.
I mean, I like The Girl Is Mine, but if Thriller had to have one song, Chop, that's The Girl Is Mine.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Definitely not.
My only problem is that with R. Kelly, you can kind of, the shit that he got caught doing, and then you think back to the music, you can hear
there's a consistency.
My mind's telling me no, but my body's telling me yes.
But that was one of the things about watching.
I'm like, yo, that, nah, bro.
Well, watching the R. Kelly documentary, I think, was really difficult for a lot of us because you did really realize, like, wow, I did know that he married Aaliyah.
Mm.
Yeah, and, like, somehow it was...
Yeah.
For years, that would be like a setup. You know, like
weird.
We were talking about
anyway,
setup records.
Like,
we were talking about setup records earlier. That would be like a setup record for me.
Right.
Yeah.
I would throw in a bumper and grind. And then I would just come on with some ill shit or whatever. And I would get most of my reaction from women.
Right.
And now it's like, yo, beyond the outrage and shit, I can't in good conscience throw that shit on.
But I mean, if you told me, a while back ago, I did play an R. Kelly song. Remember the song Be My Girl, Be My Number Two?
Yeah.
And I was playing that, and I was like, fuck, I like this song, I'm playing. And I'm listening to those lyrics, and I'm like thinking, yo, this is, he's saying he has a girl, but Be My Number Two girl, You start thinking about the shit that R. Kelly's going through, and it's just like, yo, this song is kind
of
creepy.
There's a lot of people. I mean, Atlantic Star had a song called Secret Lovers, but that doesn't mean that they were.
Yeah.
You know, it's like.
Sexual deviants.
Yeah.
It's not illegal.
Yeah, exactly. Once you know.
They didn't go to jail for playing that shit. I mean.
No, but what I'm saying is, like, it's easy to hear his songs now and be like, oh.
Yeah.
You know, but it's like.
I'm just like, oh, man.
You know what's crazy? It's like, this is kind of on topic, off topic, though, but it's like Jay-Z's, like, getting, like, the. Yo, he's in the Writers Hall of Fame and this, that, and the third.
Yeah.
And it's like, I was like, yo, you know, Writers Hall of Fame, like, what is he getting in the Writers Hall of Fame for?
You know,
like, Big Pimpin'? Like, yeah, you know what I mean? Like, what are these songs, how are they going to age? Like, these records, and I think that now, with hip-hop growing into its third, fourth, fifth decade, that we're going to have to start seeing a little bit more responsibility with where it's going and what's being said, because your legacy is going to be determined by these records. And if you're trying to do Vegas in 20 years and be a legacy act, you're going to have to start really thinking about, like, yo, I actually said bitches ain't shit. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I'm not going to be able to perform this record anywhere.
Right. You know, I think about this all the time. I'm always like, at weddings, until the end of time, people will play Mary J. Blige, Real Love. People will play, you know, Soul for Real. But all these other songs are going to disappear progressively.
And it's going to be bad because they're not aging well. They're having real trendy lyrics, like references that are of the day.
Mm-hmm.
5 years from now, we're not talking about fucking MySpace. You know what I mean? It's like, you know, that record is gone.
Right.
Like, who's playing that record?
Right.
So a lot of, you know, I think that, you know, music in general is going to have to do a little soul searching and be like, yo, we got to talk about something.
But don't you think it's also good to have a record of something like that that spoke? It's like a time capsule of that
represented but not all the records. Something at that but time. But not all of them, though. No.
But I think if you go through Jay-Z's catalog, right, and you go from the beginning to the end, you're actually seeing the evolution of a person to 444. So you're witnessing the evolution of a hustler, right? And then his mentality starting to change and evolve to what he finally becomes at 444. And that's the realness of hip hop that a lot of musical genres may not have. You know what I mean? And
but you know
I
what? Think it's a lot of records, though. He's going to be very, very embarrassed to perform in 5 years from now. He's going to be like, yo, I can't believe
Well, he just had B-sides, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Like 2 weeks ago.
Damn, I wish I could look at that. That song list, the set list.
Oh, you can go. Yeah, on YouTube. Yeah. I watched it on YouTube.
You can find it. Yeah,
but like, think about like the four Eric B. and Rakim albums. You could put all of the lyrics to those albums in a book,
and read like an album.
And exactly.
That's the difference. Like the Tropical Quest records. You know, right. What I mean? Like, you know, it was flighty and whimsical at times, and you know, it was like, you know, dreamy and stuff of that nature. But it's not going to be anything that they're going to be able to say. Damn, yo, I can't believe I said that shit.
Except for that one record. The one that didn't make Theory.
Georgie Porgy.
Yeah, I'm trying to see if he had a misogynistic song that he performed.
Jay?
Yeah.
Definitely.
But listen, I think Jay could
feeling
be...
Feeling it? Maybe...
Jay could be, you know, the blueprint, no pun intended, for young rappers. It's like, you don't have to go through... a 20-year hip hop career to kind of start making timeless music.
Like, you have the Drakes, you have the Kendricks that are, you know, J. Cole's, the Drakes. They're having a little something as far as stay in power with their records. You know what I mean?
But lyrically with Drake, I don't know about that, man.
Yeah, because he talks about topics, he talks about feelings and stuff like that. Maybe an album cut, but it's definitely something that.
But nothing like really deep though. Too deep.
Well, he does. I mean, relationship stuff is deep.
There's some. Deep stuff, pause, but nothing compared to Jay-Z.
Yeah, sometimes it's too deep. I don't want to know too much about Drake's feelings.
Yeah,
that
right. Exactly.
That's what I'm saying. Take care.
But it's relatable enough to where it's not you're gonna get on stage and just be like, I'm embarrassed that I said.
But the women love that vulnerability, like him being that open about his feelings, and he wins.
The question is like all of these records we're talking about, like Michael Jackson and all of these things that we hear. Mm-hmm. You know, you haven't really played Michael Jackson in a crowd. And seeing people wince, and and have
that energy. I was out to breakfast the other day, and they played PYT on the stereo, and the girl, there was like a 16, 17 year old girl in the booth right next to me singing along, like like bobbing her head the whole thing.
I get winces. So, I get winces.
You get winces. I get winces. Yeah, even at everyday people.
Oh my god, I've seen like winces.
10%
yeah.
of the crowd is like, what are we doing here?
I play yeah. Remember the Time. Like
they're probably just, they're not sure what to do, right?
I actually play it from the last verse of Remember the Time. That's how I'm usually bringing it in now.
Yeah,
because it's like, let me just kind of get to that part where I think, you know,
like a break, like a party break or a break beat.
Almost. Right. So I'll give you a dose of it. You'll get the gist of it. And then if it's not working, I don't have to worry about the whole record playing out. Mm-hmm. So I'll give you that. And then I'll go into, you know.
I got to say, else. I've never had a worse feeling. And even this is when I'm not DJing. When I'm watching a DJ play Michael Jackson, and I've actually seen a DJ play R. Kelly recently. There's the feeling in that room.
Sucked the energy.
Oh my
right?
God! It just I wanted to run out.
And Michael Jackson too.
When you see their reaction and you see the little pockets of people like flipping the fuck out, it's the scariest and most. And I'm just like I can't even imagine what that DJ is feeling. I want to like leave the room because I have that much anxiety, and then it's one of those things that scares the shit out of me.
But it's interesting. It's all about your society. We did Everyday People in Johannesburg in December, and the guest DJ, top of primetime, played Ignition. That room went off.
Crazy.
Really? Right? Everybody from the New York team was like, "Oh, what are you doing, bro? You can't play this record." And we're like, "Oh, fuck it, just let it run out.
That was
let it play." It's
that Bruno Mars record. What's that? That's what I like.
Yeah,
like that was my setup record. Ignition. Yeah. Usually I don't do this. Mm-hmm. And then I would just come in with the Bruno. And it would work. And then it was like the outrage came. I was like, fuck.
Yeah. Right.
Two of myself.
Yo, and after the Bruno, I would play, I'm a flirt. And that shit would always hit. Can you imagine if 10 years ago somebody told you, you're not going to be able to play Kanye, R. Kelly, or Michael
so you
Jackson
don't play
in the
Kanye.
Club? I don't play Kanye. I play like the old stuff.
People
the old stuff
crazy,
works. I played A Good Life. I play All Falls Down.
See, even when I play that, I get a little wince, and then I got to get on the mic and be like, "I like the old Kanye." And
nah, people, I don't cop out.
And
like
then
that.
People laugh. And then people laugh.
But like, I don't play the new Kanye. It's just like out of taste. Like he's got a song with Lil Pump. Like,
yeah,
you don't like that record?
I don't play it.
Wow, that
I
record
don't play
rips.
It rips, but I can't. It's like a 40-year-old man with a 17-year-old boy talking about all this. Like, it's wildly misogynistic. You're such a fucking hoe. I love it. And I'm like, what is Kanye doing? Like, I'm embarrassed by the record.
Yeah.
I know. I think
you're playing Kanye?
Yes. I've never stopped playing Kanye.
Wait, how do you feel about this, Ellie, too?
What?
Are you going to, you'll play Kanye or you're against it?
Well, I mean, I don't really ever play, like I told you, I don't really. Anyway, I actually really like later Kanye better than early Kanye these days.
Right.
Especially Life of Pablo. I don't know. I think that album's highly underrated.
It really is.
It gets a little weird in the middle. Like some songs could have
5-7 records.
Dude, it's like I listen to that and I'm like, this is how good hip hop can be.
Totally.
Right. And so there was a little bit of time when I would be playing, and then I would play y'all the only. What's that song?
Father Stretch My Hands.
Yeah, Father. Yeah. I would play Father Stretch My Hands. Like I remember I played that once at House of Yes, which is a big house music club.
Yeah.
I played it at 3:00 and it was pandemonium. Like people, because like no other DJs, it's not even a brave move. Like it was a big record, but
no other DJs do it.
And just to be able to do that. And then I played like maybe like 15 minutes of hip hop and then kind of worked my way back up. And so I used to do that a lot. And I guess I don't think I stopped because of anything he did. I think I just did it too much or something like that. Mm. But I just didn't like that last album very much.
Okay.
Yeah. It was all right. I like the Pusha T album and the Tiana Taylor album.
Yeah,
right.
I still listen to it all the time.
His standards are a little bit too high for that album.
Yeah.
Yo, like,
and the Nas album was really
disappointing. I don't have like a really strong stance on Kanye. Like, yes, I play Michael. No, I do not play R. Kelly.
Right.
Kanye's in the middle. Like, if I feel like I need to because I'm in a jam, I'll do
I'm wrong. I've been playing Otis at Dance, Dance, Dance.
Oh, yeah.
Because Otis is Kanye.
Kind of,
but not because.
Flashing Lights.
It's not, I'm not playing it because I'm like, well, Jay-Z's
right, I just
like the record.
Well, the Flashing Lights R. Kelly remix is off the table. Yeah. That one is off the table.
Totally. Totally. That was a good remix, too.
But it was a good remix. It's better than OG.
It also comes down to the room I'm in. Because if I'm in a mainstream Las Vegas room,
they don't give a shit.
They don't give a shit. I'll play the new Little Pump, or I'll play the Little Pump and Kanye.
Right.
But if I'm in a hip hop room, I'm staying away from Kanye, and that's just because I know, because he's a symbol, he's become a symbol of Donald Trump to a certain degree, and it's almost like if I play that
makes you.
Does DJ support Donald Trump? Exactly.
I don't really buy into that shit. It's like, my thing is, I'd rather throw it back at you. Like, I play what the fuck I want. So that's my stance.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So where I get it, mm-hmm. but it's a lot of fake outrage that goes with that too.
Right.
You know what I mean?
Definitely.
And there's a lot of guys that have done a lot worse than him fucking having bad taste in fucking politicians. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean?
But
so my thing is, like, I'm not beholden to the crowd to be like, hey, yo, you better not. Nah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, well, let me tell you, last year when he started doing all the MAGA shit last year,
August.
Yeah. And I think I played Father Stretch My Hands. Yeah, I played Father Stretch My Hands, and one of my partners at Everyday People ran to the booth. It's last year. She was like, Mo, cut this out. People are angry. I was like, all right, no more Kanye, right?
Right.
And that same person came back to me like early this year. She's like, I really like the new Kanye song. I don't know how to feel about it.
So weird.
Like, go say fake outrage, man.
It's such a weird time.
You can't really get caught up in that, because then you become a lightning rod for every fucking issue, and people are coming to the club to get away from all that bullshit. Mm-hmm, you feel what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So my shit is more released than anything, so I'm not trying to get you controversy.
I mean, also, like, there's so much music.
It really
been
is.
Made by people who did terrible things.
Horrible things.
People who I probably wouldn't want to.
I could say James Brown.
Yeah.
He did some bad shit.
He fuck Rick fuck James.
What?
Rick James.
Rick James. First week.
No, but also Jerry historically
Lewis.
You have
Jerry Lewis. Yeah.
Elvis Presley.
Yeah. So historically you have to look at how the media is going to paint some of these black institutions like James Brown, Michael Jackson, Bill Cosby. The way the media descends on those people is way harder. We don't know if they got dirt on other people.
Yeah, but
we don't know if they got dirt on.
I feel like they do. They just wait.
Rod Stewart, Elton John. We don't know.
This is happening now. That's why it's so like it's an open wound right now. It's not like a scar.
Yeah, but this
you know
is
what
stuff,
I mean.
It's this like, is allegedly stuff that's happened 20 sometimes with Cosby's case 35 years ago.
Yeah.
So it's not really. It's very disingenuous to think that it's a topic for now. It was a topic for 35 years ago.
And nobody said anything.
You know what I mean?
And for black people, sometimes we think, like, why are you throwing all your political, legal might to come after our institutions?
Mm-hmm.
This
mm-hmm.
is from, like, decades ago. And like, what becomes, else is going on?
And then it becomes a double jeopardy type of situation where we didn't get them the first time, so we're going to get them on this, on some bullshit, just to make up that we wanted them from before.
Mm-hmm.
So it's like, how really genuine is it?
I think Bill Cosby is a weird situation just because we're not playing any Bill Cosby records, but like I totally agree with you.
Yeah, okay, I'll give it.
I totally agree with you, but like I think like what's going on with Kanye, that's like an open wound because the youth is affected by their parents and the parents are, you know, they're seeing how it's affecting their family and how everyone's just being really like upset with Donald Trump and what's going on.
Kanye's trolling. He's trolling everyone.
But you know the crazy thing historically, and if you know about like history back, James Brown was one of the most popular artists in the world at one point.
Yeah,
mm-hmm. And he made the mistake of backing the wrong politician mm-hmm. and got years of backlash. He backed Nixon,
mm-hmm.
but he did it for a fact that he felt like, well, being at this guy, I have his ear. Maybe I can gain access to the situation.
It sounds really familiar.
It sounds very familiar. But then James Brown, 15, 20 years, he comes, does the comeback. Do we still hold him for the fact that he did that in 68
mm-hmm.
with Nixon?
Right.
He so also, is it just the outrage of the moment? You know what I mean?
It's which is amplified by social media.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, basically. Yeah.
But it's just like with the Nixon and James Brown, that's a scar that healed and it's almost fading away. Do you know what I mean? If someone wants to bring that up, they can bring it up. But I just think these are open wounds. Like they're now happening. Like the R. Kelly, I know that's been happening, but it just with the documentary, it just kind of it's like a scar that like got opened up again. And it's like an open wound. And it's one of those things where I've never as a DJ felt so much anxiety of like, I can't play this music because it's gonna like literally like offend people to a different like to the core of like humanity, you know what I mean? Like it's so deep, and it's those times.
And these are two artists who you depend on a vast
libraries and
They're not like that one song is off the list. It's like
Michael Jackson. It's like Kanye West.
They have so many hits.
Not too long ago, Chris Brown was accused of raping some chick. And then for a second, I'm thinking, God damn, I can't play any Chris Brown in the club anymore. And luckily, those charges were dropped. But I was thinking, damn, there's a bunch of Chris Brown songs I cannot play.
That sounded hilarious. I mean, luckily the charges were dropped.
But
I still got my banger set.
We kind of knew what Chris Brown was about way long ago before that, though.
I mean, it was just one incident, but still, it's just like.
But I think if you like rewind,
you guys, 10 years, I'm gonna go. This is getting a little weird.
If you rewind literally like 10 years from today,
yeah.
I think for any one of us here, the artists you played most on any given night were R. Kelly, Kanye, Michael, and probably Jay-Z, right? And maybe Beyonce.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And now that's like three of them. Taboo.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, who's next? Like, this could go on. Down the list.
And with social media, it's kind of like it's a petri dish because you never know what you're going to do that may offend somebody at this point. You know what I mean? So you're kind of leaving yourself open for whatever vice you may have or whatever shit to come up. It's going to be like, oh, you canceled. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It's that easy.
It's that scary too, because it's like you could have a whole career and it could get shut down from one moment. You could have been like a video could have gotten caught of you playing Michael Jackson and you telling us an offended patron at the club, I don't care, and that could get caught on video, and then everyone could get your at, and they could just ruin your
life. This conversation right here.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
I'm at DJ Neva. By the way.
At DJ Cricket.
Little Neva X.
At Funkflex. Yeah. Little Neva Funkflex. there's a whole bunch of stuff. You had a quick question to Ellie. Since we're talking about iconic, music Moma figures.
Oh,
with Madonna?
Oh, yeah. I noticed you're the biggest Madonna fan.
And you just want to know why?
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, why?
Explain yourself. I don't know. Like, I basically, I'm just from the era of like roller skating.
I love the early Madonna stuff, man.
I have a very specific... I used to go to the store called Wings.
I remember Wings.
Yeah.
On Broadway.
Yeah, Broadway in
93rd.
Third. Yeah. I used to go to get my polyester lees and like the t-shirts where they could put the letters on it, whatever.
Yeah.
I would get like a fresh written on a t-shirt.
Maybe like the Playboy Bunny or whatever.
Yeah, Playboy Bunny, all that. And Windbreakers, the whole thing.
Yeah.
And I can remember being there and hearing Holiday on the radio.
Yeah.
And I thought it was Evelyn Champagne King. Mm-hmm. And I was just like, this is my shit. Like, this is gonna be a big record, blah blah blah. And then I guess I must have bought that album. I recently discovered this journal that I had when I was in like 84, I guess, where I used to draw pictures and I used to draw pictures of people breakdancing and like really bad like graffiti when I was 9 years old or 8 years old. And there's mad pictures of Madonna on the whole thing, like I'll cut out from magazines or whatever. So I guess I was pretty infatuated with her back then. Uh-huh. And I used to wear like stacks of rubber bracelets. The black rubber bracelets. Yep.
Yeah.
And
you were a weirdo.
Yeah, okay. I was. It's okay. I'm comfortable with it. But I don't know. I was just really into her. But it's just I like pop music. I always did. And in those days I don't think I really like understood. I was too young to be like she's kind of like a little bit of like a poppier version of like Evelyn Champagne King,
right?
Yeah, or whatever. And I liked Shannon and all the freestyle stuff, the proto freestyle, I guess, that was coming out.
Yeah,
And then as I got older, I felt like I was still interested in the music. It ends sort of in the early 90s. I don't really listen to anything she did after that. But I think the last song I really liked was the one she did with Babyface, Take a Bow.
Yeah.
But I'm just one of those people, like, I was always like, I didn't just get into something. I was like all the way. I was infatuated with Michael Jackson, infatuated with Run DMC and Prince and Madonna and just all those like, 80s kind of like, I feel like the 80s was kind of an amazing time because the pop stars were actually also making the most exciting music. I mean, Prince was a pop star, but he was
totally agree with you.
Avant-garde, like weird ass music. Right. Mm-hmm. Like his music defines genre. Yeah. But he was also the biggest pop star. It's kind of like the way Tribe Called Quest was such a huge hip hop group, but they also were making kind of the most
accessible records. Yep.
And revolutionary at the same time. You know. Yeah. So. You know,
and then the 80s were kind of like the cheesiest era and
the best
musical era.
And then I think about this all the time. Like, am I just romanticizing my youth or is there something to it? The I think it's like the introduction of drum machines and people being able to make music without a band gave birth to all this exciting music that at this point is ruling the world, right? House, techno, hip hop. But in the 80s, it all was getting started, and that's kind of amazing.
I think maybe that's why the 80s are so amazing, because they discovered that technology, but they had the musicianship coming from the 70s.
Right.
Yeah.
Whereas somebody discovers the technology now, they never made a song, they were never in a band.
Right.
And but now you got like Kashif.
Kashif
gets a keyboard and he's by himself just jamming.
But that's cool too.
Yeah.
Because that's more of like a punk rock thing of like, I don't know how to play a chord, but I'm going to buy this machine and just figure out what kind of sounds I can make.
And they make good music.
So, So,
didn't Madonna come by Dance, Dance, Dance one night?
There was this one night when I was like, I got there. Yeah, I got there at 10. And which is when the club opens, and I get in the elevator because you got to take an elevator up.
Uh-huh.
And I'm sitting there, and the door guy's like, "Hold on a second, we gotta wait for somebody."
Yeah.
And I'm just sitting there, and then I hear this voice, really bossy, kind of like obnoxious, like, "Well, I need this, and is that gonna be here? And well, what do we do with this?" And I was like, "I don't know who this is, but they're the most annoying person ever."
Oh shit!
It's Madonna. And she walks in. She's surrounded by 20 something dancer type people, like, you know how she always has that entourage of dancers. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And she's just talking, and I'm just there like and then we got upstairs, and so she was scouting. She did a video for some song from her last album at LeBain. Uh-huh. And she was there just looking at it to like kind of scout it or whatever.
Most famous person that ever came to your party,
right?
I would say so.
Yeah. Yes. Wow. And she stayed for an hour.
I mean, do you count like Drake and Rihanna? They're not as legendary.
J. Cole came to our party.
Yeah, but
he's not as famous.
They're not legendary.
No, like, I'm just saying, like,
I think Madonna's the most legendary person.
I mean, she's one of them. She's not as famous now. Like, there was a point where you could be like, she's the most famous person in the world, right?
Mm-hmm. Right.
And it's been a while since then, but
Rihanna's more famous than her now, but Madonna's still more legendary.
Right.
Gotcha. Yeah. Well, she has the time.
Did you meet Madonna that night? Or
nah, that was another thing. Like, I'm not really one of those types of people anyway.
Uh huh. Yeah.
Like, different era. We're from a different era, so it's like.
Yeah, I don't.
The thing is, when we're coming up and DJing, like, Amenity was pretty cool. And then you, like, celebrities will come in and they're just like, they just want to chill, play the music, get out of their way, don't ask for pictures.
Yeah.
You know, don't take pictures. Yeah. You know what I mean? That type of shit.
Even just in New York.
I miss so much opportunities of fucking celebrities coming into clubs where I just was like on my chill shit because I didn't want to, you know, rub them wrong. Yep.
But also back then you didn't have a cell phone that you could take with a camera.
You could have had.
But it wasn't even that. Like, you know, a manager would come to you and be like, "Yo, Puff Daddy is here," and I'm like, "What do you want me to do? Play his songs?" They're like, "Are you sure?
Yeah,
because this is a lounge.
Right. Yeah,
right. We had to make him feel self-conscious.
Yeah,
and yo, I ran like a bad boy medley.
And did he like it?
He walked out.
Yeah. Oh, so we had a rule at Bungalow 8. This was a serious rule. Every DJ who played at Bungalow 8 knew this rule. If someone famous walks in, and you can't play any of their records. If you're playing one when they walk in, turn it off immediately.
You almost have to ignore them.
Yeah,
they feel like they're in a party.
Exactly. Yeah. 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 But for some really weird reason, the only time I did ever ask someone for a picture was Downtown Julie Brown.
Oh, wow.
I don't know why. I was just like, I was with Gems.
And do you remember a Monday night at the Good Spot? You were my guest.
Yeah, Queen Latifah was slapping me on the butt.
Latifah was there. And you know, I was with her people. So I was like, yo, Latifah's here. Me and Ellie's DJing. Yeah. Does she want to hear her music or not? And then my homegirl was like, "Oh yeah, Dana loves that shit." I'm like, "Ellie, go."
And what did I do? Wow.
You ran this Latifah set.
For
she
real?
Was wild, and she was in the booth slapping you.
I remember playing "Warm It Up," Kane, and she was slapping me in the butt when I was playing "Warm It Up," Kane. And I'm like, her first album to me is like
Holy Grail.
That's her best. Yeah.
Like, it's
one of her best. Yeah, definitely. Yeah.
I had the adverse effect happen to me. I was doing a party at the pier. The South Street Sleeper, the one on 23rd over there.
Chelsea
Beat, a frying pan. Mm-hmm. And I'm doing DJing a party, and fucking Bobby Brown is there. And everybody knows me. I know fucking love New Edition. Right, right.
Oh my God.
You know, that whole shit. So I throw a prerogative from the top like that shit. So everybody's rocking because everybody knows that I'm about to go into my New Edition set.
Yeah.
And Bobby Brown is there. And he turns to me and flips me the bird. I said, oh.
No. But that's a great story, though.
Like, yo!
He could have at least just been like that or something.
No, he
right?
flipped me the bird. Like, fuck you. But like he didn't realize that I'm not playing it to play you. I'm playing
that's
it
what you do.
To play you.
That's
you
my know set.
Mean? Yeah.
Oh yeah. Man,
yeah, that sucks, man.
How did you feel? Only he knew how you really like. You are the New Edition guy. Like,
yeah,
that's
yeah.
crazy.
Damn, man.
Have you ever interacted with him ever again?
Oh yeah. Talk
can me, I just say one thing? Ralph Tresvant wouldn't have done that.
Ralph,
you can just tell Ralph Tresvant is like the nicest dude out of all of them.
It was like, what did you want for Bobby Brown anyway? Like, what
exactly.
Like,
it's perfect. It's perfect.
I think it's a great story. Yeah, it's a great story. It was meant to happen that way.
Hey, we're hearing that time limit right now. Yeah. I wish I could talk like another 2 hours with y'all. But, I mean, Goldfinger, can we get you back and can we focus on you next time?
I don't
time?
Have anything to say.
Come on.
Jesus Christ.
All right, man. We're going to try. We'll get you in like a crew another site group. For like another crew
it's
site.
It's got to be
like
with this. These guys. Gotta
yeah, let's do it. Let's do it. Let's do it again.
Self-destruction.
Yeah. Hey, yo, I want to plug your Wednesday party that you guys have been talking about here in New York. Every week at LeBain, dance. One of the best dance parties in New York, right? Gotta be.
Yeah, I mean, that people are saying that, you know, we appreciate their opinion.
And the whole premise is just playing any dance music, any genre, as long as it's dance music.
Right on.
And it's you and Ellie, Moma and Ellie, playing every Wednesday. And then obviously, Moma, you got Everyday People, one of my favorite parties. And then Ellie, Tiki Disco, 10 years, y'all been rocking that shit. And then you just got back into radio. Radio Days on Lot Radio. And actually, you launched it last week, right? With Bobbito.
Yep.
Everything kind of come in full circle with that, right?
For sure. Yep.
Which is great. Yep. So everyone check that out. And honestly, if you're ever in New York, you got to listen to Goldfinger Spin. You have to listen to this. You have to. Yeah. And this is probably like one of the highlights of the Road Podcast, for especially me and Neva being from New York.
Definitely.
And I love that I could share this with like some of the West Coast dudes and some of the younger dudes that may not have known about, you know, some of these great DJs and their hip hop background. Yeah. In the early like 90s to like the early 2000s, which was my favorite time of it's when I was coming up, you know what I mean?
Right.
I appreciate you guys coming through. And,
thank you, bro.
Give a hand to Eli Escobar and Goldfinger. Thank you, man.
And make sure you follow us on youtube.com/roadpodcast. Subscribe, like, and comment. Hit the notification bell so you know when we upload every Friday. And then we put up throwback videos on Mondays. And so check that out.
Yeah, and this is all brought to you by DJ City. And good looking out, DJ City.
And then they're... socials for Eli Escobar and Goldfinger's Eli Escobar NYC, and then Goldfinger's DJ Goldfinger's NYC.
There you go.
Yo, thanks again, fellas.
All right, thanks, guys.
Thank you.